Solo. Okay.
Good morning again. I hope you can hear me well. So welcome to all the people who are here in Ancona, and to all the people who are online from Urbino and from other places. I'm Donato Iacobucci, Rector's Delegate for Entrepreneurship in this university. Okay. And I'm responsible for this project in Università Politecnica delle Marche. You all know about the organization of the morning. I will say just a few words and then leave the floor to other people. You know that the first edition of this project involved all the four universities in the Marche region, and once was sustained by the Marche region. In this edition, we will hear students from Università Politecnica delle Marche and Università and University of Urbino, just two universities, given the difficulties in organizing the project in this situation. So we will hear students from this university and a group of students from Urbino. Before leaving for the address of the rector of the University of Urbino, Professor Giorgio Calcagnini, which I see already online, just a few minutes, Giorgio, and to Francesca Cesaroni of the University of Urbino, who coordinated the activity in that university, and then Francesca Micozzi, who will give you some information and numbers about this edition. Just let me say something about this project, which I consider very, 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 very important. It's a project about entrepreneurship education, but I repeat it several times, and I stress all the time that entrepreneurship education is not just promoting new startups. It's something much more general. I'll get to read a recent definition of what entrepreneurship education is. This is a definition recently written by the EU Council in a document about the key competencies for the lifelong learning. And the entrepreneurship education is defined as, I'm reading, the capacity to act upon opportunities and ideas and to transform them into values for others. It is founded upon creativity, critical thinking, and problem solving, taking initiative and perseverance, and the ability to work collaboratively in order to plan and manage projects that are of cultural, social, and financial value. I agree very much with this definition, and I think that this project really is about this kind of entrepreneurship education, giving to students the opportunity and capacity to create value for themselves and for others in societies. So we will hear about how you will see the ideas that you are going to implement. I just thanks all the students, of course, who participated in the project, but especially all the other people involved, starting from, of course, the people who organized and contributed, the teachers in this university and in the University of Urbino, the teacher of teachers, because we had teachers learning about the new pedagogical methodology, and of course all the tutors that helped the group of students. The list of people is too long, so I cannot mention them all. And of course, many thanks to the people who agreed to be this morning in the jury to listen to the project and evaluate them. So especially for the difficult conditions in which we organized this project this year. So I very much look forward for the next edition and to continue on this project. So I'm glad to leave the floor to the rector of the University of Urbino, Giorgio Calcagnini, for the greeting. And just to say that our rector, Professor Gianluca Gregori, was not able to be here this morning, but it's, you know, it's, he's very, very interested in what we do on promoting entrepreneurship in this university. So maybe during the day he will be able to connect with us and say something. Please, Giorgio.
Thank you, Donato, and welcome to everyone. It's a pleasure to bring my greetings to this working day. I'm very glad that the collaboration with the University Politecnica delle Marche and the University of Urbino is carrying on very well. I think it's been quite a few years that we started something like this one, something like this project, I would say. And my feeling is that Donato knows it very well, is that trying to teach entrepreneurs something new is not easy, but what we should do is probably teach them tools, ways of reading how the economy evolves, trying to teach them to forecast innovations about technology, for example, but not only technology. So I think it is a very difficult task in a way, but we should keep trying doing this kind of work, because I'm sure in the long run it will produce effective improvements in the way our companies, especially small firms, are run. And so again, I'm glad that Donato and Francesca Cesaroni, my colleague from Urbino, are working together, and I hope you have a very productive day, and I hope everyone enjoys this working day. Thank you very much for letting me talk at the beginning of your day.
Many thanks. Thank you, Giorgio. Many thanks.
Unfortunately, I won't stay too long.
Okay.
As you can imagine, but
yeah. I know.
You will be glad to listen to at least the first one.
Okay. I know you have a busy morning. Yeah, you told me, and so many thanks for staying with us at least for a few minutes. Okay, Francesca Cesaroni, the colleague from Urbino. If you want, we will be glad to hear. If you want to say something about the project.
Yes, I'm here. Okay, good morning to everyone, and thank you to the rector of my university, Professor Giorgio Calcagnini. And first of all, I want to thank a special thank to professor, to my colleague from University Politecnico Marche, Donato Iacobucci, and to Dr. Francesca Micotti for starting and organizing this initiative, and as always, for doing it with great commitment and professionality as usual. And as Donato said some minutes ago, we can say that this is a special edition because we had to start and to organize it very quickly and with a very tight schedule because of the pandemic and because of the uncertainties about the academic activity. But despite this, we decide to go on and to don't miss the opportunity to work again together with this initiative that we consider very important for our students and for the future of our university. And we were also encouraged by the great success of the previous editions and the positive feedback we received from our students. So I am very pleased to be here today to conclude this edition. And I want also to thank my colleagues from the University of Urbino, in particular Professor Roberta Bocconcelli and Angela Genova, who together with me supervised a group of students. And we, in fact, today we have five groups of students who worked a lot and with great enthusiasm and commitment to their projects. And so I can imagine that they are very ready and they are waiting to present their projects. So I don't want to use their time and I just want to say a few words to underline why I think that this initiative is very important. And Donato has said some important things, and he remembered he has just remembered the definition of the European Union. And I agree with that definition, and I agree with the fact that entrepreneurship is the subject that it is very important, and that it is very important for us, for academics, to teach entrepreneurship to our students, because teaching entrepreneurship is important not only to foster the creation of new business, to new firms, new startups, but it's important to educate students and to help them to develop entrepreneurship that is, according to the European Union, is a key competency. It's a competence that everyone should have in order to be an active citizen, in order to be self-aware, to be fulfilled, and to be able to give an important contribution to the society, and not only to economy, but also to society in which we live. But I think that there is another reason why I think that this edition, this initiative is very important. And the reason is that this is one of the several education initiatives that are organized not only in Italy, of course, but in Europe and all over the world to promote entrepreneurship. But this initiative is something different. And the difference lies in the fact that our goal is not only to promote entrepreneurship in students, but also to encourage academics to adopt entrepreneurial teaching methods. And I think that this is very important, and is something new, something different that we do in this in prison aula, and that is not common to other education initiatives also aimed to promote entrepreneurship. And so I think that this is very important because our universities, both University of Urbino and University Politecnica of the Marche, I know that are very involved in promoting the adoption of new teaching methods. For example, in Urbino, we have a center devoted to innovation in education, in teaching methods. And for this reason, I had, even in the last edition, in the previous edition, several academics from very different disciplinary areas were involved in this project, because everyone is interested in the adoption, in learning first, and in the adoption of new teaching methods, not only teachers from business or management or economics. So entrepreneurship is a very interdisciplinary subject, and it's very important that academics from very different classes or very different courses are involved in this project. So I want to thank again Donato and Francesca, special thanks to Francesca, because I know that she worked a lot for this edition, and a special thanks also to students who have been involved in this initiative with great enthusiasm. And so I hope that in their future, this experience will be not only a good memory when they will think back to their university experience, but also something that can be useful for their professional life and for their career in the future. So thank you, and I'm ready to listen to students' projects.
Thank you, Francesca. There is we don't have the warm of applause, but we certainly agree with what you said. We share. I'm sure that all of us here share what you said. I'll leave to Francesca Micozzi while she will give you some information. Giving the floor to Francesca, just to say that we will not have at 10:30 what we had called an experience, an entrepreneurial experience. It's my fault. I tried to arrange some entrepreneurs around Europe, but we had some problems. This is the bad news. The good news is that we will take the opportunity to have a little break at 10:30, which is otherwise the morning is very is too busy. And so instead of half an hour testimony, we will have a 15 minutes break, so we will save some time. And after the break, my colleague Diego Data will give you some information about an interesting opportunity to participate for the student, for the group of students, for the idea to the Climate Launchpad, which is a competition national, EU, and then global level for ideas on for green projects. So Diego will then explain, and so Francesca, please. And okay, I'll stay and listen very with much interest to the projects.
Thank you, Donato. Good morning to everyone and to all the students here and online. Just a few words about this project. You already know, but maybe some of the people are listening are not know all about the project. So, Impresa in Aula starts with our university project is an implementation of European best practice. And we choose this type of project because in some way stimulated entrepreneurship attitude as across disciplinary competencies. In the project are involved teachers, students, and also tutors. And the project uses an innovative approach, as you know, the design thinking. And we work from March to June, and now today is the final presentation of all the projects that the students developed. So here, some picture about the project. So the phase one involves all the teacher training. And so here the teacher of our university and Urbino University learning about the methodology. And then the phase two were the implementation in class, and students were coordinated by teachers and tutors. So now we are the day of the final event, and I don't know if you already know, but there will be some award at the end. This third edition of this project involved 11 teachers, 17 projects, 4 tutors. We will have 3 awards. And in the panel judge, we have 17 judges, so from the in regional and Italian ecosystem. So here, the teacher involved, and I tend to to all the teachers that will follow us on in these months. Here the project that you will listen, and there will be an a long morning, but it will be a really, really interesting listen hour project. As I said, we have 17 judges that will judge you, that will give you some advice to improve your project, because today is not the end of a yes, it's the final event of the project, but if you want, we can continue to develop your project, as Donato said, presenting your project in other competition and so on. So I thanks everyone. So we will have people from the ecosystem with transversal competencies, and also we have a judge with really specific and technical competencies that can evaluate your project. Many thanks for Intesa San Paolo, Considi and Warehouse that this year sponsor the prize. And I don't want to say anything about this, because the Intesa San Paolo, Considi and Warehouse will speak about the prize. So thanks, and I will give the floor to the students. Just few instructions for the day. So we have some people in presence and some people offline. So the event is registered, is recorded. So we are recording the event. Please, for the judge, you have a link where you can vote the from 1 to 5 the project. Please keep going to vote, and don't wait until the end, because the number of the projects are quite high. So I don't want it that you can lose some information about the project. And for the judge, after each presentation, you will have the possibility to interact with the presenter. So just use the raise hand tool, and that you have in your Zoom, that we have in our Zoom platform, and we will give you the possibility to switch on your microphone to speak and to give some advice or ask some questions and so on. So some students, some students will speak in English and others will speak in Italian. So they were free to choose the language. So the morning will be bilingual, and that's it. I think I give you all the information. So the morning we will help the students. We will help by their tutor that follow them in these 3 months. So please, Nicole, it's your turn to present your the first theme.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I present the group of the Prof. Carlo Carboni. The group is formed by Chiara, Federica, Sara, and Fabio, and they will to talk about the project Azienda Agricola Demetra. So good listening and good luck to the guys.
Microfono attaccato, sì.
Vediamo il microfono.
Federico, are you able to speak?
Good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So I share my screen.
Yes.
And I, okay.
Perfect.
Okay.
Can you see? I know it's not easy to be the first, but okay, yes.
You see the slide?
No, the slide, we cannot see it.
Okay, one moment, please. Now, can you see the slide?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I try to, okay. So we can start?
Yes, please. You have 5 minutes, as you know.
Yes. This is the website we imagined for our enterprise. Demetra is an agricultural enterprise in which elderly people and the youngs collaborate for an innovative project. The name is inspired by the Greek patron goddess of crops and tulips, but also patron of the cycle of the seasons and of life and death. So we can define the old age as the winter of life. The idea came up by a conversation with one of our grandfathers about many problems that affect the life of the seniors, and we underlined their loneliness. So our main mission is the creation of a place where pensioners, especially the older ones, can socialize with both their peers and the people of all the ages, dedicating themselves to the production of farm-to-table products. Moreover, we well know the problem of youth unemployment, so the enterprise employs young people who nowadays seem to be more and more attracted by agricultural jobs and natural life. Another important goal is the reduction of food waste of our company, but also of other farmers, external farmers, transforming in preserves fruits and vegetables which are not sealable because of aesthetic defects. And finally, we want to retrain an abandoned area of our region. Then my another girl will speak about the activities.
The enterprise spans across 6 sectors and it is accessible through a company bus. Moreover, it is possible to ask for assistance because of impaired mobility. In all the activities showed in the images, natural fertilizers fabricated by young experts are utilized. Pensioners can also decide to take home part of the products. Other ways for spending more time in enterprise are managing the business market, open every day, where products are retailed or sold in pre-packaged boxes. Then, during the weekend, welcoming customers to the restaurant with plates cooked with local products. We also organized seasonal events during which we host local enterprises. Downloading our app, it is possible to analyze products and menu so that our employees can pack them before the customers come to enterprise.
Now we close the website and we start explaining technical aspects of the company. The choice of associative model is perfectly suitable for the mutualistic purpose that we pursue, but to be more inclusive, the enterprise offers commercial activities open not only to associates, but also to the public and whose incomes are not tax-free. We intend to finance the creation of the company, especially through the crowdfunding. Then, in addition to regional tenders for the third sector, we heard about European tenders which promote agricultural enterprises of young entrepreneurs. Two of us made a thorough estimate of cost and revenues. Revenues mainly come from the sales of products and the restaurant, but also from royalties and sponsorships. More in-detail data are written in this these tables. These are the cost and these are the revenues.
We spread a survey for understanding the social impact that our idea could generate and for improving the company's services. For example, we asked an evaluation for 1 to 5 of our project and if people were interested in working in the enterprise and buying products. Also, elderly people have been interviewed and answered the question. We are waiting for you at Demetra. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. So, for the judge, if there are some questions, please raise your hand. Yes, Lorenzo, I will give you the possibility to switch Lorenzo Compagnucci. We will give you to open your microphone. Please.
Is it working, microphone?
Yes. Okay. Yes, Lorenzo, good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for this really nice presentation. I really appreciated the name of the project and the history behind it. It is always important to build an interesting and attractive storytelling. I would like to ask you a couple of things which could be useful to improve your business idea. I really appreciate the fact that you put together active aging as well as you deliver a message of sustainability. Did you already identify an area where you can start the farm? And did you consider any specific regional or European call which allow you to use, to exploit areas in order to achieve the sustainable development goals? And regarding the localization of the area, did you consider how is it difficult to achieve this area to elderly, because the project is focused on Silver Age? So are you planning to localize the farm in a easily reachable area, or are you going to provide a public transport for elderly to reach this area? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. And we considered almost all these things, and we are sure that we would like to construct the enterprise in the hills in Marche region. One of us has also a land, but we would like to retrain abandoned area of Marche regions on the hills of Marche regions. And but our main but we consider the idea of build it in a reach in a easily accessible area, but also we provided a minibus in order for transporting elderly people there. And we did not identify a specific area, but the idea is to find an area that can be retrained and requalified by the construction or the restoration of buildings and of lands.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Federica. So we can keep going with the second. This project were developed in with the Professor Carboni and the tutor Nicole, as you see. The second project is Ego University. Davide was okay. The tutor. Please.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Davide Maggi, the tutor of the groups of Professor Cucculelli and Cerano. And now I introduce the group Ego University of Professor Cucculelli that will show you a new way to orient yourself of choice of university. And I will now hand over to Camilla Vignoni.
Buongiorno a tutti. Scusate, parlerò in italiano perché non è il punto di forza del nostro gruppo l'italiano, sì, l'inglese. Provo a condividere lo schermo. Si vede?
Sì.
Ok. E la nostra idea è nata principalmente per risolvere un problema che pochi anni fa ci siamo trovati a dover affrontare noi stessi. La fatidica domanda che tutti amano fare ma alla quale nessuno vuole rispondere, specialmente 18-19 anni, che è chi vuoi diventare da grande. Abbiamo analizzato il perché di questa problematica e abbiamo individuato tre principali problemi. Il primo è che noi ragazzi non ci sappiamo orientare nel panorama qui in italiano, quindi non siamo a conoscenza tutte le università che ci sono quindi ad oggi in Italia. Il secondo problema è stato quindi posto, studiato dall'ANSA e ha riscontrato che 2 studenti su 5 non si orientano, quindi non sanno scegliere se entrare nel mondo del lavoro o scegliere un'università. Il terzo problema è che molti studenti si pentono della scelta che hanno fatto e si trovano appunto ad entrare nel mondo del lavoro o a cambiare l'università perdendo pure tempo. Per risolvere appunto questo problema è nata Ego University. Abbiamo idealizzato un sito che è composto di 4 sezioni, la prima About Us che parla di noi, della nostra idea, la seconda che è il cuore del nostro sito che è la survey, quindi un questionario che va ad analizzare personalmente tutte le persone che si introducono al sito, la terza quindi è l'università, quindi va ad analizzare tutta l'università del panorama italiano a 360 gradi e per ultimo quindi i contatti che siamo noi, principalmente noi studenti che ci mettiamo in gioco e poi quindi un'esperta, quindi una psicologa che si occupa di affrontare i problemi e poi per ultimo una chatbot. Abbiamo deciso di affrontarlo appunto con Ego Survey, che è la chiave del nostro sito. È un questionario che va ad affrontare tutti i punti di forza o di debolezza dei ragazzi, oppure quindi delle proprie ambizioni, per capire se hanno delle idee chiare su quello che vogliono diventare. Alla fine di questo questionario quindi verranno poste 3 soluzioni, quindi di 3 università, che poi quindi loro sapranno scegliere quindi per dare quindi un'idea nella scelta dell'università. Alla fine di questo questionario mettiamo anche a disposizione quindi la facoltà di poter confrontarsi con degli studenti alla quale viene posta quindi a loro stessa quindi scelta, oppure quindi a poter parlare appunto con degli studenti che stanno affrontando il loro percorso quindi universitario. Ego University invece quindi attraverso dei filtri va quindi ad analizzare quindi nel dettaglio in maniera più completa possibile le università appunto che abbiamo in Italia. Le nostre buyer personas non sono quindi specifiche, in quanto non abbiamo quindi un target di riferimento quindi delineato. Andiamo quindi a parlare a James, che è un ragazzo di 18-23 anni, che è appena uscito quindi dal diploma e deve capire appunto il suo percorso universitario. E parliamo invece con Emily, una ragazza di 22-25 anni, che invece esce dalla triennale e deve capire se continuare gli studi oppure entrare nel mondo del lavoro. Cosa ci distingue dai nostri competitor? Sicuramente il contatto che noi siamo con una psicologa, in quanto ci rendiamo conto che è un problema importante, in quanto quindi questa domanda va ad influenzare la nostra quindi carriera lavorativa. Il contatto quindi possiamo quindi andare quindi a selezionare le università quindi italiane in maniera più chiara e corretta possibile, in maniera anche completa, e per ultimo quindi questo contatto che noi offriamo anche con altri studenti, in quanto riteniamo che sia la scelta quindi più valida, in quanto quindi facciamo parlare studenti con altri studenti. La nostra quindi offerta si compone compone due pacchetti, sia per gli studenti sia per l'università. E le nostre quindi ricavi si basano appunto, quindi ipotizziamo di raggiungere 5.000 studenti che faranno l'abbonamento qui in advance e in 10 mensi università che avranno quindi, faranno quindi il pacchetto premium. I nostri costi sono ridotti, restando un sito, quindi non abbiamo dei costi da affrontare altri. Abbiamo principalmente quindi la piattaforma che andrà ad analizzare quindi i questionari e a rispondere quindi alle domande, e per ultimo quindi la psicologa, che sicuramente saranno i costi più importanti. Questi siamo noi, quindi siamo quindi quando andiamo quindi nei contatti, nella sezione contatti, troviamo quindi sia noi tre, che siamo gli studenti che abbiamo fatto questa nostra idea, ma sicuramente anche la psicologa, che è il nostro punto di forza. Questa è la nostra quindi business model Canva, che va a riassumere quindi quello che ho detto. E per concludere dobbiamo fare un appunto sul sito, abbiamo chiamato Ego University, con la I vogliamo andare a identificare appunto l'utilizzo delle risorse quindi digitali, che è la base appunto della nostra idea, il Go per rendere l'idea che vogliamo raggiungere un qualcosa e soprattutto insieme quindi vanno a formare quindi l'ego, quello che spinge quindi a fare le nostre scelte, quindi anche la nostra ambizione principale, e University è l'ambito appunto di riferimento della nostra, quindi della nostra idea. Grazie per l'attenzione.
Okay. Any questions? Alessia Amato.
Sì, buongiorno. Mi sentite?
Sì, buongiorno.
Buongiorno. E proseguo con la domanda in inglese, in italiano, quindi.
Sì, grazie.
Sì. Ok, perfetto. Una curiosità più che altro. Nel vostro piano c'è quello di coinvolgere solamente gli studenti di ogni università o magari gli uffici orientamento presenti all'interno di ciascuna struttura?
No, proprio gli studenti, perché non vogliamo, okay. Cioè con le segreterie è facile parlare, basta fare una chiamata all'università di riferimento. Vogliamo proprio far parlare e dialogare degli studenti con altri studenti che stanno affrontando in prima persona il percorso universitario.
Ok, perfetto, grazie, era giusto per capire.
Ok. Now, free green pasta. Professor Cesaroni, if you want to introduce your team, please.
Yes, Francesca, thank you. The next group is Free Green Pasta. I am the supervisor of this group, and this group is five students belong to this group. They are Domenico, Elisa, Raul, Alessandra, Benedetta. And I think that they are ready for their presentation. And so I give the floor to them.
Okay.
Okay, here, Domenico, please, you can share your presentation, your screen. Okay, thank you. And yes, you can start.
Si vede?
Yes, we can see you.
Allora lascio la parola a Elisa.
Buongiorno a tutti, e anche noi parleremo in italiano perché l'inglese non è il nostro punto di forza. Allora, eating pasta is nice, but without plastic it's even better. Per la nostra startup abbiamo voluto utilizzare il simbolo per l'ecosostenibilità affiancato al grano, che ovviamente richiama il prodotto principale del nostro business. La denominazione della nostra startup è Free Green Pasta, che oltre a sottolineare la sostenibilità, richiama anche la vendita sfusa al dettaglio della pasta. La causa che ci ha spinto a portare avanti questa idea è il sempre maggior bisogno per l'ambiente di essere tutelato a causa dello spreco di plastica, che spesso viene smaltita in modo non consono nell'ambiente. E purtroppo anche le imprese che vendono la pasta contribuiscono a questo fenomeno andando a speculare sull'utilizzo dell'imballaggio, facendone lievitare il prezzo. E più o meno abbiamo stimato un 60% del costo riferito al packaging, compreso sia di pubblicità e della grafica.
E come soluzione il nostro progetto si propone di andare a risolvere entrambi i problemi attraverso la riduzione dell'impatto ambientale, che un business così green non dovrebbe avere. E allo stesso tempo vogliamo venire incontro ai nostri clienti permettendo loro di risparmiare e contemporaneamente appoggiare la nostra causa. E la pasta è sempre stato un prodotto essenziale nella nostra cucina, ma è molto apprezzato anche in tutto il mondo. E in particolare durante questa pandemia c'è stato un incremento del consumo mondiale del 16% e questo ha comportato anche un maggior spreco di plastica.
Mi sa che abbiamo un problema con l'altra ragazza, quindi direi che andiamo noi. E il nostro prodotto consiste nell'apertura di piccoli negozi ecosostenibili, dove verrà venduta pasta sfusa e andando a limitare comunque al minimo gli imballaggi di qualsiasi genere, sia di plastica che di carta. Offriremo un'ampia gamma di pasta secca dove il cliente potrà ottenere un effettivo risparmio e andremo così a fidelizzare anche i nostri clienti tramite dei servizi aggiuntivi, come può essere quello anche della pasta a domicilio. Il consumo mondiale di pasta ammonta a circa 16 milioni di tonnellate, rappresentativo comunque del mercato totale possibile. Tuttavia noi vorremmo concentrarci su medie città, la cui popolazione ammonta a circa 100.000 abitanti. Tramite un sondaggio da noi elaborato durante il corso, è scaturito che circa il 70% di coloro che hanno partecipato verrebbe ad acquistare in un nostro negozio, andando così a delineare il mercato che potrebbe essere quello, diciamo, ottenuto in futuro. E successivamente abbiamo analizzato anche il posizionamento dei nostri concorrenti. Le due variabili sono date dal prezzo della pasta e dall'attenzione che si ha verso l'ambiente. Come si può osservare dal grafico, le grandi distribuzioni forniscono a un prezzo basso la pasta, ma con una bassa attenzione all'ambiente, al contrario di quello che invece offrono i negozi biologici, ovvero un alto prezzo, ma anche un'alta attenzione all'ambiente. Il nostro obiettivo è quello di posizionarci nel miglior compromesso tra basso prezzo e tutela dell'ambiente. Secondo il business model da noi stimato, tenendo conto del nostro mercato, ogni singolo negozio dovrebbe servire circa 67.000 clienti per un totale di 1,5 milioni di chili di pasta all'anno da servire. Il margine di guadagno per ogni chilo di pasta è stato calcolato più o meno in 20 centesimi per ogni chilo, per un valore totale netto di pari circa 314.000 euro all'anno per il singolo negozio.
Il team siamo noi, ovvero 5 giovani ragazzi amanti della pasta, anche con un occhio di riguardo per l'ambiente, ognuno con delle esperienze diverse, anche se tutti e 5 siamo dottori in economia e attualmente stiamo anche conseguendo la laurea magistrale. Ci siamo uniti per portare avanti con determinazione questo progetto e accettiamo comunque chiunque condivida la nostra idea. Ed è per questo che i nostri finanziamenti deriveranno principalmente da una raccolta di fondi tramite una piattaforma di crowdfunding aperta a tutti, a cui spetterà ovviamente una remunerazione in base al loro impegno. Quest'ultima sarà garantita dalle somme ottenute, diciamo, dei ricavi di tanti piccoli negozietti. Inoltre, in aggiunta di questo, siamo anche disposti a conferire personalmente il necessario per poter avviare e gestire la nostra attività e raggiungere il nostro importantissimo e ambiziosissimo obiettivo. Grazie per l'attenzione.
Ok, grazie a voi ragazzi. Abbiamo da parte della giuria qualche domanda?
Sì, c'è una domanda da parte di Lucia Aquilanti.
Intanto abbiamo attivato a Serena Spiariotto.
Vado io?
Serena Sgariotto. Sì, prego.
Buongiorno a tutti.
Buongiorno.
Avrei solo una domanda. Avete pensato per caso ai contenitori che i clienti utilizzeranno per portare a casa la loro quantità di pasta?
Diciamo. Avevamo già ipotizzato comunque a dei contenitori o di plastica riciclata oppure anche di latta, e con i quali comunque si riesce, diciamo, sia a tenere la pasta in casa, perché diciamo c'era anche il problema, che capita più o meno a tutti, di avere tanti sacchetti sparsi in casa di pasta già aperta. Quindi avere dei contenitori di plastica riciclata o di latta all'interno dei quali si vanno sia a comprare, diciamo, la pasta che dove si andrà a contenere la pasta in casa. Quindi per, diciamo, anche ridurre gli spazi e questo è così. Dopo questo avevamo già progettato anche la tipologia di contenitore dove c'era anche la posizione per gli spaghetti, per la pasta corta, eccetera. Quindi questo l'avevamo già pensato.
Grazie.
Grazie. Bene, Lucia Aquilanti aveva la stessa domanda, quindi...
Posto.
Benissimo, perfetto. Bene, possiamo... We continue? Sorry if we speak from Italian to English and vice versa, but Professoressa Cesaroni again with another project.
Okay, yes, thank you, Francesca. The next group is the Green Amp solution. The students of this group are from the University of Urbino. I am the supervisor, and they are Paolo, Ilaria, and Filippo, that I see Paolo in the screen. So I think that you are ready. Can you share your slides? Okay, so if you want to share your presentation, now I see Paolo on the screen, Ilaria.
Yeah, Ilaria.
Yeah, you can see your slides, so you can start. Yes, I suggest to choose the presentation mode. So thank you.
One moment, please. Okay, we are ready to go. Buongiorno a tutti, siamo tre ragazzi appassionati di Green Economy e molto attivi nella ricerca di materiali alternativi che possono in quel modo andare a sostituire i prodotti a base di petrolio. Nelle prossime slide presenteremo la nostra startup dal nome Green Hemp Solution. Come tutti sappiamo, oggi giorno una delle tematiche più allarmanti è quella dell'inquinamento e dello smaltimento della plastica. La plastica è molto tossica, come tutti sappiamo, sia per le persone che per l'ambiente, dal momento stesso in cui inizia la sua produzione fino al suo smaltimento negli inceneritori. Si stima che appunto ogni anno vengano prodotti tra le 250 e 300 milioni di tonnellate di plastica e solo il 10% di queste viene riciclato, mentre il resto finisce in discarica come o nell'ambiente come strame. Dunque, la nostra idea è Green Hemp Solution, che si occuperà di realizzare gli allaggi in bioplastica. In particolare, i nostri imballaggi di canapa, di bioplastica in canapa, riducono le emissioni di CO2 del 30-80% rispetto alle plastiche tradizionali e risultano essere più resistenti rispetto alla plastica di utilizzo comune e addirittura 10 volte più resistente rispetto all'acciaio. Sono biodegradabili, riciclabili e esenti da tossine ed infine sono perfettamente indicati per la conservazione di cibi, data la loro atossicità, e indicati anche per la conservazione di prodotti di largo consumo, data la loro resistenza. Passo la parola al mio collega.
Salve a tutti. Allora, il mercato delle bioplastiche ha generato circa 1.100.000 tonnellate di prodotto, con un tasso di crescita previsto del 17,5% entro il 2025. Nello scenario italiano gli imballaggi in bioplastica non hanno competitor diretti e dunque questo mercato risulta avere le caratteristiche di un oceano blu. Quindi appunto ci sono grandi opportunità in questo settore date anche dalla scarsità di concorrenti indiretti e dall'assenza di concorrenti diretti. In particolare i concorrenti indiretti sono Canesis, che è un'azienda siciliana che ricava materiali plastici dalla canapa per la realizzazione di filamenti per le stampanti in 3D, Sana Packaging, che è una società che realizza imballaggi in canapa, che però è situata negli Stati Uniti, e The Ice Republic, che è un'azienda che realizza montature in canapa biodegradabili per occhiali. Un nostro potenziale cliente potrebbe essere la Saponaria, che è un'azienda appunto che si trova vicino a Pesaro, la quale produce cosmetici naturali, privi di imballaggi e privi di sostanze nocive per la salute e per l'ambiente. Noi appunto potremmo fare gli imballaggi in canapa per questi prodotti. Passo la parola al mio collega.
Sì, salve a tutti.
Per quanto riguarda la struttura dei costi, Jim Epp, presidente della LobCon a North America, un produttore di articoli usa e getta che ha collaborato con fornitori di bioplastica, ha affermato che i pellet di polipropilene a base di petrolio oscillano tra un dollaro e un dollaro 15 centesimi a libra. Se la plastica di canapa dovesse competere con la plastica del petrolio, il prezzo della libra dovrebbe essere superiore a 1,27 dollari su libra. I prezzi attuali si aggirano su numeri leggermente superiori e sono intorno ai 2,35 dollari a libra. Infatti, come afferma anche Hepp, nessun imprenditore vuole pagare di più. Vogliono tutti avere i vantaggi della bioplastica, ma nessuno vuole pagare di più rispetto alla plastica convenzionale. Anche i consumatori finali sono disposti a pagare un piccolo premio aggiuntivo, ma non pagheranno mai il doppio del prezzo rispetto alla plastica convenzionale. Un altro aspetto da tenere in considerazione per i possibili investitori è quello invece relativo però all'andamento del prezzo del petrolio. Infatti, quando aumenta il prezzo del petrolio, il costo della bioplastica sarà molto più economico. Possiamo ora passare invece alle forme di finanziamento scelte per il nostro business. Abbiamo il crowdfunding, la venture capital e la corporate venture capital, gli acceleratori, gli incubatori e i business angel, infine. Possiamo concludere che noi il fine del nostro lavoro è quello di in qualche modo contribuire alla salvaguardia dell'ambiente, nello specifico riducendo l'inquinamento derivante dalla plastica. E inoltre possiamo anche affermare che tale business ha un potenziale molto elevato, date le caratteristiche del prodotto e il mercato emergente elencati precedentemente. Grazie dell'attenzione. Ho letto che c'è una domanda.
Sì.
Chiara.
Chiara Giosuè. E poi Lucia Aquilanti. Prego, Chiara Giosuè.
Allora, buongiorno a tutti. La mia domanda è questa. Se avete già pensato al fine vita di questo prodotto? Vi ponete come obiettivo appunto di andare in questa fetta di mercato? Come avete ipotizzato di risolvere la questione?
Quindi un attimo, non ho capito bene la domanda. Quindi la
quando
prima
si arriva
di, come inserirsi nel mercato?
No, la domanda è proprio una volta che una volta che il vostro prodotto è stato venduto, è stato utilizzato, e quindi io ho comprato un prodotto che è stato col packaging prodotto dal vostro che è stato il vostro hemp, come mi comporto, cioè in quale come mi devo comportare? E poi se vi siete posti questa domanda arrivati alla fine vita quindi del vostro materiale.
Allora, la bioplastica in canapa si degrada in tempo molto molto breve, quindi anche per questo si stava pensando per il fatto magari di poterlo utilizzare su imballaggi, ad esempio, dell'acqua, comunque sia non hanno una resistenza forse adatta perché si degradano velocemente. Quindi un'ipotesi potrebbe essere quella di smaltirli separatamente dagli altri rifiuti, a parer nostro, cioè nel senso comunque sia il prodotto si degrada velocemente in modo naturale. Quindi non è come le altre plastiche. L'unica problematica è che nella trasformazione della bioplastica in canapa, della canapa in bioplastica, vengono aggiunti anche degli additivi chimici. Quindi o creare proprio un apposito rifiuto per la bioplastica in canapa o addirittura buttarlo nella plastica normale, di normale utilizzo, perché poi questa sostanza chimica comunque sia, anche se il processo di degradazione del prodotto è molto veloce, c'è questo elemento chimico che un po' rallenta questo processo di degradazione del prodotto. Ecco, non so se ho esaudito nel modo corretto la risposta.
Bene, grazie. Lucia Aquilanti.
Ok, perfetto. Penso che adesso mi sentiate. E io avevo due curiosità, lavorando ad una facoltà d'agraria, quindi mi ha incuriosito e interessato. E la prima è se avete fatto un'analisi della, diciamo, possibilità di approvvigionamento della materia prima. Quindi se trasformate canapa dovrete trovare coltivatori di canapa.
Sì.
E l'altra è se vi siete, ho visto, vi siete orientati verso il packaging di cosmetici, ma se avete considerato anche il settore food, che oggettivamente potrebbe avere margini ampi di possibili guadagni.
Allora, per quanto riguarda questa seconda domanda, sì, ci siamo anche orientati sul packaging di tipo food, per il food, perché comunque sia la materia prima, cioè la bioplastica in canapa, è molto versatile, quindi molto adatta alla conservazione di cibi, perché non contiene tossine, quindi è totalmente esente da tossine. Poi effettivamente si andrà a creare un film, no? Un film di plastica, di bioplastica, ad esempio per il confezionamento di alcuni prodotti come del food in questo caso, che sono effettivamente più resistenti rispetto alla plastica di normale utilizzo. Per quanto riguarda la prima domanda che lei ha fatto, sì, ci siamo, noi comunque sia siamo una startup, ora inizialmente, poi vedremo in futuro, che trasformiamo solo esclusivamente in questa prima fase la canapa in bioplastica, quindi ci occupiamo solamente della trasformazione, giustamente come ha detto lei ci agganceremo a dei coltivatori di canapa, degli agronomi. Il settore della canapa purtroppo è un settore che è in espansione, questa è anche una grandissima potenzialità, appunto come abbiamo detto durante le slide. E in questo caso siamo al pari passo con le normative vigenti, perché ci stiamo rendendo conto che ogni mese ci sono delle norme diverse rispetto alla coltivazione della canapa industriale. Quindi ecco, da gennaio è possibile sicuramente coltivarla, quindi anche al sud vi sono delle coltivazioni di agronomi che se ne occupano. Quindi ecco, stavamo cercando di orientarci intanto nel territorio nazionale. Poi eventualmente in un futuro... anche in America comunque sia loro già la utilizzano, e quindi magari poi ci agganceremo
anche,
ad altri coltivatori.
Anche nelle Marche, anche nelle Marche, sì, così vi do questa buona notizia.
Sì.
Va bene, vi ringrazio.
Oh, bellissimo! Grazie a lei.
Ok, thank you. And now Professor Genova from University of Urbino.
Thank you very much, here we are. Grazie a tutti, quindi Dipartimento di Economia, Società e Politica, corso di laurea in gestione delle politiche dei servizi sociali e della mediazione interculturale. Il corso è quello di politiche per la salute, modelli e pratiche, e il team è composto da Elisa Allegrezza, Francesca D'Antonio, Antonina Iannolo, Martina Morbidi, Vittoria Panbianchi e Magda Porcheri. Grazie, a loro la parola.
Prego, possiamo, vediamo le vostre slide.
Perfetto. Salve a tutti. Allora, perfetto. Anche noi procederemo in modalità mista, infatti il PowerPoint è in inglese, mentre la presentazione sarà in italiano. Allora, diciamo che il nostro progetto nasce all'interno delle aule dell'Università di Urbino, con l'intento di far rinascere dopo il Covid il piccolo comune di Monbaroccio, che è un borgo immerso tra le colline dell'entroterra pesarese. Monbaroccio vuole essere il caso studio di un'idea imprenditoriale e sociale, ideale anche per altri borghi o piccoli comuni. La pandemia da Covid-19 e le rispettive misure di sicurezza adottate hanno influenzato le nostre vite, spaventandoci, isolandoci e impoverendoci, dal punto di vista sia economico che relazionale. Siamo partiti dall'analisi dei dati di una ricerca esistente fatta sulla popolazione di anziani del borgo e attraverso un approccio empatico abbiamo creato degli ideal tipi. Let's restart from people significa proprio ripartiamo dalle persone. Chiara, Mattia, Orlando, Silvia e Rosaria sono ideal tipi che abbiamo creato per far fronte ai bisogni emergenti all'interno del borgo. Lo strumento del lavoro iniziale è stato il Business Model Canval, che ci ha aiutato ad impostare la struttura del progetto. Dalla sinergia delle studentesse dell'amministrazione comunale è nata l'idea di stimolare la partecipazione dei cittadini per la creazione di una cooperativa di comunità. I vari bisogni emersi sono il bisogno di relazioni, i servizi e attività per l'infanzia, i servizi per l'autonomia, la conciliazione vita-lavoro, i servizi di sostegno per caregiver, il sostegno alle capacità genitoriali, la ripartenza economica, la parità di genere e la realizzazione di luoghi accessibili ed inclusivi, punto molto importante per noi. Riteniamo che fare cose insieme possa rappresentare la strategia più efficace per soddisfare tali bisogni. Partendo dalla riqualificazione degli spazi indoor et outdoor forniti dall'amministrazione comunale, il progetto intende favorire le relazioni sociali, valorizzare la creatività delle persone, rendere il borgo accessibile ed inclusivo, promuovere l'economia del territorio locale ed il turismo sostenibile, consolidare il lavoro di rete e favorire la partecipazione consapevole. Ora passo la mia, passo la parola alla mia collega Morbidi. Grazie a tutti. Non ha il microfono attivo la mia collega. Puoi venire qua? Passo il mio computer, siamo vicine per agevolare il lavoro.
Ok. Partecipazione e advocacy, coinvolgimento. Coinvolgimento dei cittadini, confronto, coprogettazione, sostenibilità. Sono queste le parole chiave che hanno guidato la nostra idea imprenditoriale. E con quali partners intendiamo intervenire? Allora, intendiamo intervenire con l'amministrazione comunale, la Proloco di Monbaroccio, la parrocchia, le associazioni presenti nel territorio e gli imprenditori locali. Concretamente, il nostro progetto si realizzerà in 5 fasi. Nella prima fase avverrà la costruzione del tavolo di lavoro, nel quale verranno coinvolti gli studenti, l'amministrazione comunale e gli enti del terzo settore. Nella seconda fase ci sarà il confronto e l'ascolto circa i bisogni dei cittadini, promossa dall'ente formatore Creative e dagli studenti attraverso incontri pubblici, conferenze e assemblee. Nella terza fase avverrà la formazione dei cittadini riguardo la cooperativa di comunità e attraverso la collaborazione di formatori professionisti e l'ascolto delle esperienze realizzate in altre realtà, come ad esempio quella di San Leo. Nella quarta fase avverrà invece la creazione di una cooperativa di comunità come messa in trasparenza di una realtà che ne ha bisogno ed infine, come quinta ed ultima fase, si intende dare avvio alle varie attività e ai numerosi progetti. Intendiamo dunque dar vita ad una cooperativa di comunità che svilupperà i seguenti progetti, ovvero la riqualificazione di un'area messa a disposizione dall'amministrazione comunale e la creazione al suo interno di un punto ristoro, Caffè Alzheimer, un insieme di incontri rivolti a malati di Alzheimer e ai loro familiari, coinvolgendo le organizzazioni del terzo settore che hanno già esperienza sul campo, come ad esempio l'associazione Non Omino di Pesaro. E attività per la terza età, ovvero orto sociale, laboratori manuali, creativi, in collaborazione con l'Auser, e ciclo Domenica in Borgo, che prevede varie attività a cui poter partecipare la domenica, ad esempio mercatini, picnic, passeggiate comunitarie, attività per bambini, ed infine Cinque Sensi, un percorso naturalistico educativo per bambini. E la promozione e la diffusione del nostro progetto punta ad essere sostenibile, per questo si baserà principalmente sull'utilizzo dei social network e cercherà di limitare il più possibile l'uso della carta. Per monitorare e valutare l'efficacia abbiamo pensato di utilizzare indicatori valutativi di tipo quantitativo e qualitativo, questionari di soddisfazione e gradimento, livello di partecipazione dei cittadini. Infine, per realizzare il progetto abbiamo previsto un investimento di 90.000 euro tra costi relativi a capitale e costi ricorrenti. Riteniamo di poter riuscire a coprire il costo del progetto attingendo a finanziamenti europei previsti da appositi bandi. La nostra mission sarà proprio creare spazio per dare spazio ai bisogni. abbiamo concluso la nostra presentazione con una frase che rappresenta la nostra idea di comunità. Grazie per l'attenzione.
Grazie a voi. Abbiamo una domanda. Lorenzo Compagnucci.
Credo sia attivo il microfono adesso.
Sì.
Okay. Grazie della presentazione. E avrei un paio di curiosità. Come mai avete selezionato le fasce di età, credo all'inizio 2 anni, 3 anni, 16, 42, 75, però manca la fascia, che so, 20, 35, magari è una ragione specifica a livello demografico del comune di...
No, in realtà non sono fasce d'età, abbiamo preso degli ideal tipi e quindi abbiamo scelto diverse età, bambini, adolescenti, quindi ad esempio 16 anni, poi adulti, quindi abbiamo ipotizzato Silvia appunto 42 anni e Rosaria 75 per inserire comunque nella fascia anche i più anziani.
Quindi grazie.
La nostra idea è proprio quella di partire dal particolare, quindi dalla persona nel concreto, e poi generalizzarla a tutta la popolazione. Quindi non c'è motivazione dietro all'età, sono semplicemente degli ideal tipi che racchiudono poi una fascia un pochino più estesa. Sono ideal tipi come esempi, diciamo, di un collettivo più ampio, ovviamente.
Mi è piaciuta molto l'idea generale di un living lab, sia come spazio fisico sia come spazio virtuale di rigenerazione urbana, e sicuramente già vi sarete informate, c'è una letteratura interessante sui living lab urbani, e rispetto al vostro progetto potrebbe essere utile individuare attraverso l'analisi di questa letteratura quali strumenti partecipativi possono essere maggiormente funzionali ai vostri obiettivi, per capire come coinvolgere i stakeholder e quali stakeholder coinvolgere. Ho apprezzato molto la mappatura degli attori del territorio che intendete coinvolgere, perché avete già identificato quali sono le loro potenzialità. E un altro suggerimento, ci sono molti ingredienti, ci sono molte idee, e poi nella parte finale avete elencato quei progetti, e mi sento di suggerirvi magari di approfondire un progetto pilota per strutturarlo in maniera un pochino più solida. In ogni caso, complimenti per l'idea, per la visione globale e l'analisi che avete condotto. Grazie.
Grazie mille davvero.
Ok, good morning everyone. I am Pietro.
Sì.
I am happy to introduce you first group of professors and analysts. They are composed of 5 students that are currently attending the food marketing and management class. Their project is called as Montessori, and they will present today online their project.
Sono online.
Non va quello per te. Tanto abbiamo la parola.
Ok, perfect. Good morning, everyone. I couldn't turn my microphone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I will share my screen. Okay. Can you see the presentation?
Yes, please.
Good morning. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So my name is Helen Daku, and I'll be presenting on behalf of my team, and then Luca will continue with the presentation. So our team name is called Innovo Foods and our product is called Manchi Soy. So this project was done to address the issues of protein deficiency in children in Western Nigeria. Based on this, we designed a product that contains high amounts of proteins that can be appreciated by children because of its amazing taste, color, and shape. These are my team members. Okay, so back to our problem statement, we decided to tackle the issue of protein deficiency among malnourished Nigerian children with low access to their food dietary needs. And of course, there's a vast number of research papers on this topic. So straight to our empathy stage, and we decided to empathize with two personalities, the children being the victims and the mothers who are responsible for making food choices for their children. And throughout this empathy stage, we realized that the mothers need to be educated on alternative food options, and then the children need to consume major amounts of high biological value proteins in their diets. So we decided to go with four personas, being the mothers, children, doctors, and an MPU. We settled with the mothers because they make the food choices for their children, and their children are the victims of the situation, but not necessarily the cause. We decided to choose a doctor as a persona because we believe that they serve as a medium of trust between initiatives like us and then the families. And these families trust the judgment of doctors. And because our consumers are not generally equipped to afford the products, we decided to also choose an MPU because they are going to help finance the project. From our point of view, we realized that the customers live in an environment where farming and animal production is seen as a source of income and not as a source of nutrition. From a doctor's point of view, we also realized that this situation is prevalent because of their food consumption patterns. So based on these reasons, we decided to ask ourselves a few questions. So we wanted to know how we might improve this situation in Nigeria, how we might find a solution that can be taken up by an MPO, how we can make a product that will be accessible to the consumers, how we can make that product appealing, and how we might gain the trust of mothers concerning the product, and then most importantly, how we might create shared value.
Okay, so our job to be done is providing access to high biological value proteins. And for this, we identified pains and gains. So possible pains are poverty and mother's lack of awareness. And pain relievers are awareness creation with education, more protein options, and shared value. Gains are a higher amount of high biological value proteins in their diet. And gain creators are proteins with a high amount of essential amino acids, consistent supply, so accessibility. So we should propose a product enriched with high biological value proteins. And for our idea to be fully realized, our product must have high biological value proteins, must be safe and with a long shelf life. Also should be tasty and with an appealing color because it's for children, should be easy to consume, portable, sustainable, and low cost. So in prototyping our product, we used soybean aquafaba and whipped it with cream of tartar to obtain a meringue-like structure. And then we added concentrated soy milk and the other dry ingredients, including the insect flour. So the mix was then placed on parchment paper and baked at 100 degrees C, and then packaged. So our product is dried soy milk bites enriched with insect proteins that can be consumed directly or rehydrated. Then we performed a nutritional study, and we found out that the recommended protein daily intake is of 13 grams per day from 1 to 3 years old, 19 grams per day from 4 to 8, and 34 grams per day from 9 to 13. And the estimated protein content of our product is of 3.07 grams of proteins for each 7-gram bite. Then we performed a sensory testing where the hypothesis was that at least 75% of children will like the product. And we tested it on 30 children, simply asking them if they liked the product or not. And the result, 80% of children liked it and 20% disliked it. So next step will be performing a more specific or complete nutritional study and then do medical study to test the effectiveness of our product on the protein deficiency problem. Thanks for your attention.
Any questions from the judge? Yes, there is a question from Ronnie Garattoni. Please, Ronnie.
Hi, good morning, and thank you much for your presentation. I'm very much interested in this project, even because I've been working for development cooperation project. So I know this question problem about malnutrition. And one question is, you are speaking about Nigeria, because probably you have some data about this country. But I'm sure that this problem is also spread for sure, even in Southeast Asia. And I have some personal experience in Central America, in Guatemala, for example. You were mentioned, so I mean, the problem is very, very much bigger than Nigeria or sub-Saharan area. I will suggest also to approach not only NGO, because this is the one that involved, but also international organizations like WHO or FAO, because they are the one they are funding this kind of project. So once your product is developed and this is ready to test the market, probably one thing to do is also to approach this kind of international organization and see if they can insert your products in their program. Thanks. I have some contacts on this regard, so we can speak when you have developed your project. We can go in details. But okay, congratulations.
Thanks for the suggestions.
Okay, another question from Lucia Aquilanti, please.
Okay, thank you. So I have also appreciated your project and your presentation. I have just a question, and it is related to the fact that I don't know, maybe I missed to catch this information, if you have considered the final cost of your product, and if you have also considered a sort of distribution network. This, my question is in some sense related to the question of my colleague. So if you have considered also the distribution of this very interesting product.
Okay, so this is a really good question, because so related to the cost, we're thinking about a shared value approach. So we based our product in being a soybean product. So generally speaking, low cost, and also giving the possibility of people in villages. In our case, we personally choose Western Nigeria to have a really specific location. And so giving farmers there the possibility to directly grow the soybean. And regarding the distribution, we thought about that as well. We're thinking about, let's say, having doctors to directly provide the products to villages, countries, etc. But also there are foundations that, through schools, directly provide the product to children.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good question.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
So now we have finally you're in presence. So we are really, really happy to have microplastic team from Professor Serrano in presence. Davide, if you wanted to introduce your team, if he's in presence.
Yes, they will explain the operation of a filter to reduce microplastics, and so they are in presence, so I hand over to the whole group, and good luck.
So good morning to everybody. So microplastic is a biomimicry filter built to collect and biodegrade microplastics thanks to the innovative use of plastic eating fungi. The wordplay microplastic with a letter Y replaced with the image of a fungi was chosen to give the idea of what is our project target and functioning. The terms biomimicry instead emphasize the fact that our filter mimics the forest effect of marine angiosperms. And the image in our logo gives the idea of the presence of microplastic into the ocean. So one of the problems of the presence of the microplastic pollution is that the small size particles can enter the food chain, eventually ending up on people's plate, along with pathogens and environmental toxins that can attach to the particle surface. And these can create medical issues for human beings. 5 grams, that is the weight of a credit card, is the amount of microplastic ingested per human being in 1 week. And as you can see here, microplastic can both be present in drinking water and seafood in high percentages. But the real question is how microplastic arrives on our table. Almost every kind of activity can release microplastic into the ocean, from brushing our teeth to industrial activity. In developing our project, we focus mainly on the textile industries that in fact release a big amount of microplastic into the ocean. And once it in the ocean, it is difficult, if not impossible, to retrieve microplastic. The solution is to prevent microplastic from entering in our ocean in first place. The possible solution are to act on the developmental phase of clothes, or the one that we propose is to act on the industrial sludge, using our microplastic biomimicry filter that, as I said before, does not only remove microplastic, but also biodegrades them, removing the problem of further microplastic disposal. This is the video rendering of the filter. The structure is made of ceramic and the filter are made of stainless steel. As you can see, microplastic can be installed at the end.
Non si vede su.
Aspettate allora. Lo condivido.
Allora, stai ancora condividendo la presentazione, quindi. Sì. Esci dalla presentazione un attimo. Ok. Adesso condividi il video.
No, non qui. Cioè, come condividerei una presentazione? Ok.
Il video è
fermo. Ok. Questo qui? Sì. Okay, this is the video rendering of the filter. The structure is made of ceramic and the filter are made of stainless steel. As you can see, microplastic can be installed at the end of drain pipe of textile industries or industrial laundries by scraping it with a thread system. First of all, from this picture, you can appreciate the tubular structure, which alternates a smaller to bigger section. It was designed in order to slow down the water flow. Moreover, you can see that each color corresponds to a different mesh size of the filter. This choice was inspired by the forest effect made by marine angiosperm, like Posidonia oceanica, in order to trap microplastic and avoid the clogging of the filters. Once microplastic are filtered due to gravity, they fall into the bottom part of the structure, and this is the most innovative part of our idea, because inside of it, there is a microcosm of fungi. But what is so special about this fungi, you could ask? Well, this fungi biodegrades microplastic through an enzymatic process using petroleum-based polymers as a sole carbon and energy source for their survival. And since each fungus biodegrades different type of plastic in different time periods, this is the reason why we decide to use a group of them to be sure to eliminate all type of plastic.
Okay.
chiudo. E ci siamo? La vede?
Sì. Guarda la slide successiva, va avanti da questo video, ok, mette la schermo intero.
Okay, regarding the personas, we identified the two main industries to which we would sell our product to, and these are textile manufacturers and industrial launderers. This choice comes from the realization that almost 35% of all the microplastics that are released into the environment come from the washing of synthetic textiles. And these make up 60% of the world yearly fiber consumption. Two examples of companies that could invest in the research and development of our product are Aquafil Group, a leading company manufacturer of polyamide, and Tonello, an Italian company that specializes in garment washing, dyeing, and finishing. Coming to the SWOT analysis, starting from the strengths, our product differentiates itself from other possible competitors because it's a natural-based solution that takes inspiration and works with a biological component that completely biodegrades the microplastics. The weaknesses mainly come from the fact that the project is still in its early stages, meaning it would need extensive scientific research and funding. But the opportunities are that now more than ever, there is an emerging need for a product like ours because of the worsening state of plastic pollution on one hand, but also thanks to the increasing awareness of the public on the topic, in return, creating in the market room for development and growth. Finally, the only possible threat could be the negative connotation that the public might have about the use of fungi. But this comes from misconceptions and lack of knowledge, and therefore could be solved by running an informative campaign on the topic. Thanks for the attention.
I have a short and quick question. Thought of applying for a patent, or is it patentable?
We're still in the early stages of this development, so we still haven't thought about patenting it, but it could be a possible future idea.
And that you register still, your trademark?
No, not yet.
Okay, I don't know if there are other questions from the online.
Yes.
Sorry.
Production cost of your device?
Well, yeah. So we need a lot of research on the product, and we estimated a price of about 100,000 euros for to start for the 1 year of research. To study the project.
But no, of the final device.
Of the final device.
Kind of type. You have any idea of?
Well, it's pretty difficult to tell. It's pretty difficult to tell, but we think that the major part is actually the research part, so the part of it before the final production of the product. So we concentrated more on the research, on the cost of the research than the cost of the production.
Okay. No?
Okay.
No more questions. Thank you to you. So, last project before the break, Professor Carboni, Nicole, please. Introduce your team.
Okay, I present the group formed by Aurora, Denise, Eleonora, Valerio, Christian, and another Valerio. The group is of Prof. Carboni, and they will speak about net utilities. So I leave the floor to Valerio, who will present the project.
Okay.
Thanks. Can you see the project?
Yes.
Okay, so we can summarize our idea in these few words. Don't be just a normal customer for better understanding what we are talking about. So we will start from the right questions that are, do you regularly use services such as electricity, gas, and telecommunication? And would you like to earn both money and time from the use of those services? Naturally, we know the answers from this question, because all of us would like to earn free time and money from the use of this type of services that are services that we are forced to use in this modern era, in the digital age. So we can develop our idea from this consumption. So we appeal to all the people that are interested in extra earnings in terms of free time and money. So potentially to all the consumers of these services, but especially young students, workers, those who have an entrepreneurial spirit, the most ambitious one. So if we go further, on the personas we focus on, we have a lot of profiles, and the main resource in our project is about people. So we have different targets. So some example, for example, Sarah who is a student, or probably Lorenzo, who is a worker and would like to earn more money and free time, and his normal job simply doesn't give him this opportunity, or maybe Marco, that is a father, or just anyone who want to improve their lifestyle in terms, especially of free time, that is the most important resource that we have, more important than the money. So we have some interesting data about the sharing era, because we are moving in the sharing field. So there are a lot of consumers that are interested in the sharing communities, in participate in the sharing communities. So we have a positive trend, and is all about a transition from passive to active consumption. So we have a good potential of expandability. But how it works? As we mentioned, the main problem solving idea is about money and time. So the main focus is about get out from the hamster wheel. So that now is possible thanks to the digital era. And we have a strategy about that. The strategy is about using the sharing economy method. So the keywords are win-win strategy and collaboration. So we are in the era of collaboration, not competition. For get better results. And then the most important question that we need to answer is, do I consume my usual services without earning anything, or do I decide to become an active consumer? So we will use also the green economy method, circular economy, in order to make the system self-sustainable and more efficient. And the operative plan is about start from the website and social channels with our website, then moving to online advertising, events, and management and support of all the clients and the active collaborators in this project. So our goal, as we said, is about to give more free time and money to all the people, simply redirecting their passive consumption within our network. So we are talking about a multi-utilities network. We are talking about the economy network. And the main problems and solution of our project, as we said, are the too much high capital for start a business. And now we will have a starting capital from the redirection of consumption of these services. These basic services, and then the elimination of the classical figure of the salesman in telemarketing with a new figure of the digital entrepreneur. the problem of the hamster wheel that we will resolve with a revenue that is disconnected from the time factor, the problem of pollution solved with green and collaborative economy, and then for finishing, we have the unemployment and passive consumption that is solved with the active customer system. But our secret ingredient is about the contacting projects. So we will share profits with the users, and each individual user will be paid in a meritocratic and ethical manner based on the volumes that they handled through an entrepreneurial earning system that allows the single user to create an income disconnected, as we said, the time factor. So we will use the marketing funnel with a creation of a commercial network with lead generation. Then we have three fundamental steps that are the creation of the campaign with Facebook, maybe Instagram ads, Google ads, and more. The user experience that will start with social networks, to opt-in page, then email marketing system, and the presentation that will guide the user to an online meeting for exploiting our network. And for finishing, an example of the cost of the campaigns. So for share the opportunity for the users and for the company in this sector. But our main goal is about optimization of the campaigns. In fact, we can obtain with less than 20 cents, as we can see, a contact, a number, so an email, so a potential consumer and collaborator. And we will use the potential of the duplication, because we will start this process, but then the user will do exactly what we done. So the user path is really simple. Redirection of consumption, sharing the idea, and then duplicate for earn money and time with this system. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you to you. Any questions? Okay, so now we have 15 minutes break, 10 minutes break. Ricordo alla giuria gentilmente di abbiamo sentito i primi 8 progetti da votare, quindi vi esorto a aprire il link e iniziare a votare, altrimenti poi alla fine è molto complesso ricordare tutti i progetti. Quindi riprendiamo alle 11, a tra un po', grazie.
Mais vuoi uscire un attimo dalla condivisione?
Ok. After the break, we can start again. So I leave the floor to Professor Diego Dada for this initiative, so all the students can participate. So please, Diego.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Francesca. Thank you, you organizers. First of all, I would like to congratulate with you because I listened to your ideas, your interesting ideas, and I saw your passion in presenting that. And also congratulations for becoming entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurship is not only about money, at least, but it's also about creating value, as Martin was saying before, creating value for you and for your society. Well, any of your projects are looking into that direction. I will take just a few minutes to present you this opportunity that is called the Climate Lunch, but it's basically an idea competition, real idea competition. So it's looking to make green ideas compete with each other and develop, most of all, develop. This is called the Climate Lunch because the main focus is about climate challenges and circular economy. And I'm happy to see that many of your projects are in that direction. Most of all, Climate Lunch is an opportunity to further develop your ideas. As Donato was saying before, your journey started here, but it's not over. You have the opportunity to further develop your ideas and take them to the next step. This may be an option. The main thing about this opportunity is that gives all participating ideas, all participating teams, the opportunity to get new skills and tools and to be trained to further develop your ideas and potentially make them viable also in terms of business viability. What is offering and what are the dates? Well, basically the main thing I think that is offering is not money, it's mainly about training the skills. There will be the opportunity to be trained by skilled trainers. And for Italy, we're gonna have trainers from the Bank of America. And the training will be the dates. You can submit any kind of idea, even very preliminary ideas to here. Basically, you can submit the idea just clicking here and giving just a very short description of your idea of your team. Then there will be a selection, basically, of ideas, and the ideas. The next stage will have a course. First, a close course at the starting of July, and at the end there will be another training and with a bootcamp with this trainer coming from Bank of America. And then there is competition. Competition will be in August. It will be in September, basically. First at the national level, then at the European level, and then at the global level. So you're going to be competing if you decide to at the global level with many other ideas. Last year there were kind of 3,000 ideas all over the world. This will be the very first year for Italy. We just joined this initiative with Università Politecnica delle Marche, and the other partners are an NGO from Switzerland that is Circular Influence, an NGO that is carrying on projects about circular economy, and Bank of America will be the other sponsor offering the training for you if you decide. That's it. If you have any question, you feel free to ask to me, Donato, or Francesca. We'll try to reply to your question, if any. Thank you.
Thank you, Diego. This is a really interesting opportunity for all the students and also startups and spin-offs.
So now, Panda Cream, please, Grusha.
Hello everyone. I am introducing the second group of the professors and all that. Their project is called Panda Cream. They are composed of five students that are currently attending the food marketing and management class. They are composed of five people, and today two of them will present, Federica and Maria Teresa. Now stage is...
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm Maria Teresa, and she's Federica. And today we will going to show you our the work of our team. So for our project, we followed the design thinking steps, and the first step is the empathize step. So we started to focus our attention on the problem, basically on the health, dairy health problems focused on children. So from one side, we can see the lactose intolerance, and from the other one, the milk protein allergy. Regarding the lactose intolerance, as we can see from the map, according to the Italian Association of Lactose Intolerant, in Italy are more or less 40% of the population suffers of intolerance, lactose intolerance. While among the allergy, in cow milk proteins is one of the most important problem for the, that one of the most cause of the allergy. And especially milk in general is the second main problem in food allergy. So to better empathize with our consumers, we decided to create a survey that we spread throughout specific Facebook groups and also fans. And in 1 week, we got 199 answers about their consumption habits. The most important results, as you can see, is that most of the people of the answers show us that they are not satisfied with the product specific for children, and also that there are a lot of missing products on the market for children. So then we decided to define our target that are both parents and children. Why? Because as we can see from the map, children will ask for the children that are lactose intolerant or milk protein allergy, will ask for new snacks to the parents, and then the parents will look for those products on the market, and the company have to produce a suitable product for them. So from the problem to the solution, we decided to create a refrigerated snack that is missing for these people, and using vegetable milk. So then we created the Panda Cream.
So the prototype step is about to find solutions that are testable. And I want to introduce you Panda Cream, that is our product. Starting from the description of the sketch of our packaging, that is a child food packaging. And then we'll continue and you will see also the model of our final product. So here you can see the regulation in 1169 of the 2011 requires the presence in the packaging the some of most important information, and here you can have two information, so the list of the ingredients and the nutritional table. And regarding this last information, so the nutritional table, it stands out a lot from the nutritional table of a product that is already present in the market for its healthy composition, and also for the use, thanks to the use of some genuine ingredients. And I want to add also that the list of ingredients and the nutritional table are based both from the prototype that we realized. So here you can see also all these steps that are required for the preparation of Panda Cream, from the realization of this chocolate sponge cake to the realization of the filled cream until we get to the assembly step. And I would like to focus your attention on the picture number 4, where we realize different cream with the use of different different ingredients, coconut milk and almond milk, to understand better which were the best nutritional composition, the texture, the final texture, and then also the taste. So here we are in the test phase where we could understand which were our impediments, but also what worked most. And this is a kind of test, I mean, especially a sensory experiment, where we could understand the feedbacks of the children that are actually our original users. So this is the result of our experiment, and we obtained that 9 children over 10 were totally satisfied of our panda cream. So this was about the present, and what about the future? We would like to work on these steps, on the improvement of these aspects, so to the increase of the shelf life, to the acquisition of some important certification, for example, the vegan, because for the sponge cake, for example, we introduce some eggs. So we would like also to reach this this certification and to improve so the preparation of the sponge cake. And at the end, we would like to offer to the market different flavors. And that's all. Thank you for your attention.
Any questions for the team? No? Yes.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I really enjoyed the pictures of the prototypes. If you were in presence, we could taste the panda cream. And I have a couple of questions. Did you realize the brand, the pictures and the packaging? Because it is very nice. And do you intend to address a specific market segment? For example, would you like to focus on vegan and organic shops? Or would you like to look also at large retail shops?
Okay, thank you for your question. So starting from the first, I would like to say that about the packaging, it was a sketch that we realized. So we didn't actually realize it. Only the product were realized.
Yeah, and which was the panda as our mascot, because it is really important for children to have like a mascot that will remain in their mind. And about the places where we want to sell it, we were thinking to sell it. Basically, we were thinking to supermarkets mainly, because according to the answers of our survey, most of them are looking for dairy-free products on supermarkets mainly. So we think that is easy for the parents mainly to find the products everywhere in the supermarket. So,
okay, thank you. No more questions? So, thank you. So now, pick group from Professor Cuculelli and Davide, please introduce your team.
Yes, I renew the greetings to everyone. Now, pick group of Professor Cuculelli will expose and explain how to do a survey in a different way. I'll turn the floor over to Nicolas Breccia. It's online.
Yes.
Now I share my screen. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Non mi fa condividere lo schermo.
non te lo permette di fare, oppure non riesci a trovare l'iconcina sotto?
No, l'ho trovata, però non mi dà problemi.
Riprova adesso, non stato poco.
Riprova.
No, non me lo fa aprire. Non so se magari proviamo a far condividere all'altra ragazza, intanto io presento.
Sì, assolutamente. Maria Teresa? A Maria Teresa? No, scusami, a Antonella?
Pia Palumbo o Pia. Antonella okay. Tancredi?
Ok. Stiamo vedendo qualcosa.
E ora ci siamo.
Benissimo.
Ok, perfetto. Good morning to everyone. I'm Nicolas. Today I introduce you to PIC. PIC is a visual survey that helps businesses capture their customers' perceptions. When we buy a product, especially on internet, we rely exclusively on our perceptions, especially in the online market. The product that is able to be perceived as the best and suitable for us win the competition. If you want to sell a market leader product, the product must be perceived as the leader just by looking at it. So let's start with the problem. Companies need to understand how to create the product aesthetically so that it is perceived as better and suitable for its customers. In these two examples, we imagine a face cream company trying to figure it out what packaging to use to create a saleable cream. Then a company that wants to understand what kind of website to build according to the preferences of its customers. How do we solve this problem? Thanks to PIC, companies will be able to evaluate perceptions of their customers and create perfect product. The company will be able to create aesthetically perfect product, make its business strategies effective, and obviously analyze data on purchasing preferences. Can you hear me? Okay, Pia, vai avanti.
Yes.
The company, as I said before, will be able to create aesthetically perfect product, make its business strategies effective, and obviously analyze data on purchasing preferences. These you see are the weaknesses of our idea to which we respond with these strengths. We capture the visual perceptions. The survey is very fast. We analyze the data and above all, we do an analysis before launching the product in the market, avoiding dangerous and risks for the companies. These are some key numbers of our market, 623,000 e-commerce in Italy, a great increasing of newsletters, subscriptions in the last 5 years, 98% of the best company use surveys, and 87% of normal surveys are not completed. So this is our buyer persona. In general, we refer to all companies that own an e-commerce. Now, let's see how it works. The company provide us with the list of contacts subscribed to their newsletter along with the purchase data. We process the data and send our visual survey to specific people based on their purchase preferences via newsletters. At this point, customers receive the newsletter from the company in which they are asked to express aesthetic preferences. In this way, they also will feel part of the business decision and they will be loyal. Within the newsletters, they will have a link that will direct them to our visual survey, which consists of a short sentence and images to choose from. In the first example, we asked the customer of a cosmetic company what type of pack they would prefer for a new line. In the second example, instead, we asked the customer of an e-commerce website which of these web structures they believe is best for the purchasing and for the product they buy. At the end of the survey, we will be able to associate customers' purchasing preferences with their perception of the product, and then provide the company with important data to create a perfect product that is perceived by their customers in the correct way.
The data will be processed in wrappers within an exclusive company page. In this way, companies will find the perfect design for their product to increase sales in their market. Now let's see also the business model. Peek has two key partners, MailChimp for the newsletters and Aruba for data maintenance. The main costs are those of creating the survey software and data analysis. While for prices, we have opted for three different subscriptions, as you can see. And then this is a small economic analysis that relates costs to revenues in the first 2 years. By following a specific strategy, we will be able to reach the break-even point with 45 annual contracts. This is our team. We would like to thank Davide and also our Professor Cucculelli for the advices during our journey. Thanks for your attention.
Okay. From the panel judge, we have some questions. No, I don't think. Okay. We can keep going. Now, Safe Tonight. Please, Alessia, your team.
Good morning, everyone. This is the first group of Professor Ciucchia, Safe Tonight. So, Alessia and Dorinda, you have 5 minutes, please.
Can you see me?
Yes.
Dorinda, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. I'm trying to... Sto cercando di condividere lo schermo.
Ok.
Così.
Ok. Good morning, we are Orilda and Alessia, two students of the Faculty of Economics and Commerce, and today we wanted to present our project we have worked on, and it is called Safe Tonight.
So, we don't know about you, but we believe that at least once in your life, you felt threatened or maybe afraid of walking down the street. So what if we told you that the next time you're in one of these situations, you're in danger, you're panicking, you don't know what to do, all you have to think about is pressing a button. This is Safe Tonight.
Safe Tonight is a personal safety device useful for anyone who wants to feel safer in the everyday life. Safe Tonight is a physical button connected to the app of the same name. And simply press it for a few seconds and the app will automatically perform the preset functions on the mobile phone. The features are the first, send a message or a pre-recorded call containing a request for help and live geolocation to the chosen contacts and or to the police. And the second is the mobile phone start recording audio or video. The button has a practical loop on the back that allows you to wear it with a bracelet, watch, attach it to a key rings and much more. To have access to the application, simply enter the alphanumeric code you can find in the package. And this is the application we have created. Safe Tonight solved the principal problems as the attack occur very quickly. And therefore, Safe Tonight guarantees a quick rescue response, greater safety, and it is also very easy to use. Through the survey, we found out that most people were afraid of walking alone at night and most would consider purchasing Safe Tonight. And throughout the same survey, we have identified the three types of personas that would buy Safe Tonight. Giovanna is a student who wants to feel safer at night. Luca and Alessandra, who would like to make their son feel safer when he goes on a trip. And Matteo, who would like to feel protected when traveling.
Why now? Well, first of all, because the digital evolution and advances up to this day made it possible for mobile phones to execute a complex series of action just with a click of a button. But I think that the most important cause is that the numbers of victims of street harassment is rising, and it is all around the world. But as these numbers suggest, Italy is no different. So while we can't tackle the problem at the root, we can try and avoid severe consequences for who's attacked. Competitors, well, we found something similar to our product in the market, but there's a striking difference with these, because all of these are luxury brands. They sell jewelry with built-in alarms, while on the other end, we aim to create a product that could be affordable to most. And what you say tonight? Well, first of all, because unlike pepper sprays or other personal safety device, Safe Tonight causes no harm, nor to the attacked, nor to the attacker. And so in case of a mix-up, there's really no problem. And it's affordable, and it's really easy to use. Like, setting it up is just as easy as posting a story on Instagram. And amongst our goal, in the near future, we would like to create a community that could then build they could build and develop a new future. The app will notify other Safe Tonight users in the area with a location and a request for help. We believe that every item should be sold at 15 or 25 euros per device. And with the product, you also get like warranty plans, maybe to replace your device, or maybe if the battery needs changing. You can also get matching accessories, or maybe eventually premium features with a yearly subscriptions. We think we'll sell our products both online and in physical stores, and we're trying to build a customer service staff re-entering previous victims of assault. Where do we put ourselves in the market? We have three ways of starting up our company. We either get our funds and we start on our own from scratch, so we build everything on our own, or maybe we have partnerships with already established companies in the markets, so we can start like at an higher level. So this is our team, and thank you for listening to us.
Okay, thank you, girls.
Thank you.
No questions from the panel judge, so we can keep going with a team from Urbino, Professor Cesaroni. You wanted to introduce SafeMe.
Yes, the next group is SafeMeal, and this project is proposed by a group of students from Urbino. I am the supervisor of this group, and the name of the members of the group are Matteo, Gianmarco, Veronica, Sara, and Francesca. So the floor is yours. You can share your presentation.
Okay.
Okay, Sara, okay.
Arrivo subito.
You can choose the presentation mode.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Nell'elaborare la nostra idea imprenditoriale, noi ci siamo ispirati alla vita quotidiana di noi studenti universitari, ma in generale a tutti coloro che hanno poco tempo a disposizione, limitate risorse economiche, scarse abilità culinarie e soprattutto pochi ingredienti in frigo. Quindi ci rivolgiamo anche a lavoratori, famiglie mono e bicomponente, nel tentativo di fornire loro una soluzione a questi problemi, abbiamo creato SaveMeal. SaveMeal è un'app in grado di fornire ricette veloci, sane, economiche, semplici e gustose, sfruttando principalmente gli ingredienti che si hanno a disposizione, in modo tale cercando di ridurre al minimo gli sprechi di cibo.
La nostra applicazione ti permette quindi di selezionare gli ingredienti che più preferisci e di utilizzare vari filtri per scegliere le tue ricette in base alle tue esigenze di tempo, a delle esigenze alimentari, alla flessibilità e alle risorse economiche che si hanno a disposizione. Il fine è quello di ottenere delle ricette specifiche alle proprie esigenze. E un'altra novità della nostra app e della nostra offerta è quella di cercare di attirare i vari utilizzatori per creare una vasta community.
In questa community sarà possibile condividere, cercare ricette e comunicare all'interno per scambiarsi i vari consigli culinari. In questo modo la nostra app è in grado di alimentarsi da sola grazie appunto alla ricetta portata dagli utenti. Sarà anche possibile recensire le ricette altrui e ci sarà inoltre contest per invogliare le persone a interagire all'interno. Chi lo desidera, ovviamente, potrà condividere le ricette anche sui social più noti. Proprio la creazione di questa community rappresenta l'elemento distintivo che ci contraddistingue dai nostri competitor, quali Infrigo, Svuotafrigo, Trova ricette Giallo Zafferano.
Con alcuni di questi competitor il nostro progetto prevede di avviare delle partnership di collaborazione, infatti con siti di ricette quali Giallo Zafferano, Cucchiaio d'Argento, Fatto in Casa per Voi, stringeremo una partnership basata su uno scambio di reciprocità che prevede da parte nostra il pagamento di una percentuale commisurata ai click ricevuti per ogni ricetta. Questa rappresenta la prima categoria di partner che caratterizza la fase 1 del progetto con durata 1-2 anni. Dal secondo anno in poi si apre la fase 2 in cui sarà protagonista la community. E l'altra categoria di partner a cui facciamo riferimento è l'e-commerce di vini, che fornirà vino in abbinamento alla ricetta scelta con spedizione immediata. Infatti Winelivery consegna entro 30 minuti e in questo caso riceveremo un compenso a fronte della pubblicità fornita.
E i nostri ricavi li acquisiremo soprattutto da pubblicità, vendita del nostro database di utilizzatori ed una percentuale sulla vendita di vino dell'e-commerce appena citato Winelivery. E sulla nostra app saranno disponibili anche dei servizi premium a pagamento per aggiungere alle ricette selezionate valori nutrizionali o allenamenti personalizzati oppure anche ricette stellate. I costi invece che sosterremo inizialmente saranno quelli di sviluppo dell'app, che dopo alcune ricerche abbiamo stimato essere intorno ai 32.000 euro. Avremo anche costi di marketing che ci permetteranno di essere visibili con pop-up e pubblicità sui maggiori e principali social quali Instagram e Facebook e anche indicizzazione su Google. Altri costi che sosterremo saranno quelli amministrativi, quelli IT e delle nostre banche dati, a cui si aggiungeranno poi costi minori di ricerca e sviluppo. E abbiamo anche ipotizzato di raggiungere il punto di break-even point intorno ai 3-4 anni dalla nascita della nostra app. E SaveMeal è un'app gratuita che sarà possibile scaricarla da Google Play e Apple Store. E grazie per l'attenzione.
Ok, thank you.
Ok. Un attimo che...
No questions. Ok. Now from Professor Laura Trucchia, please, Alessia, your team.
Yes, so let's move on. This is the second group of Professor Trucchia, Smart Tourism, Giulia and Sofia, with Black Girls.
Hello. Mi sentite?
Sì.
Ok.
Okay, so good morning, everybody. My name is Julia, and let me just try to...
Julia?
Sì, scusate, ho un problema con la condivisione schermo.
Nessun problema. Ora. Take your time. I don't know if Sophia can help you.
I have some problems.
Try to open your presentation and then...
Yes, it's opened. Okay. Sorry.
È saltata la connessione.
Sofia? Ok. If we want... Yes, to... I don't want to lose time. So take your time, girls. I will... introduce with the Professor Bocconcelli from Urbino.
Yes.
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, everybody. So I'm very proud to introduce this project by six girls of the Restoration School of our university. And I really learned a lot from them about art and culture. The six girls are Maria, Sara, Alessandra, Arianna, Raquel, and Chiara. The name of the project and the objective of the project is Stand Up. So, Maria, if you are ready, the floor is yours.
So, we made a short video for the presentation and then a PowerPoint. So,
thank you.
No, non va in full screen.
Sì, riusciamo a vedere sia lo schermo che a sentirvi.
Ok,
perfetto. Allora, this is our project.
Un po' piano, se riuscite ad avvicinarvi al microfono sarebbe meglio.
So, as art conservation students passionate about art, travel and video games, we worked on an app project whose purpose is to get users involved in local cultural heritage, even those who are not usually into ours. Stand Up is an applied free-to-play video game for mobile devices which links fun and learning in an interactive way. This app will lead people to play the role of cultural hunters seeking the Italian heritage, making players conscious about the hidden beauty around them. Stand Up is a wordplay between Stendhal syndrome and the verb to get up. The first one could be defined as the aesthetic sickness, occurring when people are in front of an artwork or a phenomena of great beauty. The second one is a verb that represents our intention to get people travel and visit what is around them. But why stand up? We live in a time where the pandemic has forced us to change our lifestyle. In a way, it has challenged our relationships due to the COVID restriction. However, it has surprisingly given us the opportunity to rediscover the places and treasures that we weren't used to appreciate. In order to catch this opportunity, we came across the idea of a project with aim to restart on three pillars: personal culture, economy, and tourism. As a matter of fact, Italian cultural heritage is a spiderweb spread all over the country. The large amount of cultural underrated sites is well shown in this report, which links Italian trails to local resources. To develop our idea, we followed a gradual process. The first step was a preliminary form to identify the personas. Since most of the interviews resulted to be interested in art and video games, as you can see from the pie chart, we thought that a video game could have the right tool to increase the people's knowledge about cultural heritage. Then we applied design thinking tools such as the value proposition canvas and the business model canvas with the aim to at developing an app that prioritizes the consumer's need and wishes. So we split ourselves in three work groups based on our best skills, aptitudes, and personal interests in order to grant efficient teamwork.
No, okay, so. Sorry, my fault. So here it is, Stand Up. On your left, you can see the avatar we designed to lead the gamer through the journey across this game experience. Loading screens are pics of Italian hidden beauties and change every day of the year. In the down left corner, there's a link that lets you discover where the shot has been taken. In the second screenshot is showed the main menu we designed to be clear and intuitive. The third screen is divided into two sections. One shows the personal profile of the player with their avatar, username, level, experience points, distance covered, number of discovered sites, an album which contains postcards collected to unlock achievements, and last but not least, the chosen team logo. Another one section shows a list of your friends and info about them. This is the main game screen. It's an interactive map which shows the points of cultural interest nearby. From the upper left corner, you can access to your personal profile. In the upper right corner, there's a compass that can guide you in the correct way from the and from down the right corner, you can access to a screen that shows you nine nearest points of attraction, their distance, and the icon lets you understand the typology of site. From this screen, you can also check if there are other players around you. From the central yellow button, you can access the main menu, and from the camera button, you can open your camera. The principal aim of the game is to gain points. To do so, you must collect the major amount possible of sites. Every site is matched with a QR code that must be framed with the phone camera to read information about the site and to gain points. To gain bonus points, users can also answer quizzes designed specifically for each site. At third level, is ask the player to join a team. Every player can help the team in winning special prizes, accumulating points and making the team climb the rankings. These are the three teams available in the app, so that every player can choose the one most congenial to them. The three teams are archaeology, art history, and art conservation related. Every year, pole position gamers and the best team will win rewards such as culinary or cultural experiences, free tickets and subscription for museum or personalized tours. Stand Up will be available for free and in different languages on App Store and Play Store, with the chance for the player to obtain a premium version with the exclusive functions. Thank you for the attention.
Thank you to you. So, yeah, we have a question from Professor Iacobucci, please.
I don't know if you can hear me. Can you hear me? Yeah, just maybe I missed something, but how will you get revenues? You said that the app is free.
Okay. We talked about a premium version of the app with extra functions that can help us to finance our application. And then we thought about a project of crowdfunding.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Compagnucci. Yes, Lorenzo, please.
Thank you for the presentation. I really like the idea of gamification of culture. And I would like to understand, you propose a non-site game. Did you think about a remote game in order to ensure a follow-up to the project and to develop a community which can act, which can interact with your game also when you are not in Urbino, for example?
No, because we thought this app for enhanced travel and tourism, so not from remote.
But you can have an interactive way to use the app because of the teams. You can interact with other teammates between a chat or through the app. But on-site is the principal aim to this game, to restart the tourism and discover the culture and improve your personal culture.
It would be useful to think about also about a remote version in order to reach what Professor Iacobucci highlighted, in order to ensure revenues from the app. Really, really nice idea. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. So if Julia and Sofia from Smart Tourism fixed their problem.
Yes, yes, I hope so. Want?
Here we are. Sorry.
Okay, no problem.
Okay.
Please.
Niente, il Mac proprio non permette la condivisione schermo. Ragazzi, è una cosa incredibile.
Anche se la apri prima sotto.
Sì, sì, no, è aperta sotto, ma...
Vai su, l'apri sotto e poi vai, fai nelle varie finestrine e prendi proprio schermo, la prima che trovi. Sì. O desktop o qualcosa del genere.
Allora.
Ok, bene.
Si vede?
Sì.
Ah, ok, perfetto.
Ok.
Eccoci qua. Ok, so good morning everybody. My name is Julia. And yes, and together with Sophia, we came up with a business idea we would like to share with you. I can only imagine that most of you have been finding it difficult to travel like before. Cosa sta succedendo?
Giulia, l'ho presentata io.
Ah, ecco, ok, scusa. I can only imagine that most of you have been finding it difficult to travel like before the COVID-19 pandemic, what with all the restrictions, the fear of being surrounded by crowds of people, and perhaps some of you have completely given up on traveling altogether. How we work and how we spend our free time has completely been revolutionized by this global pandemic. And unfortunately, the tourism sector has been hit really hard. In Italy, the tourism sector has plummeted to an all-time low in 2020, with a decrease of approximately 67 million tourist arrivals in 2020 compared to the previous year. And since the tourism sector, according to Istat data of 2015, weighs 13% of Italy's total GDP, we're talking about a significant loss for our country. As the figure shows, the regions that were mostly affected by COVID were the northern regions of Italy, as Veneto experienced the highest drop with a decrease of roughly 12 million arrivals, and Lombardy registered the second highest decrease, losing about 9.5 million tourist arrivals between January and December 2020. But let's not forget that pre-pandemic tourism also had its...
Sorry, Julia. Okay, yes. Now we... Okay,
sorry.
Presentation keeps going. Okay, thank you. Sorry.
So let's not forget that the pre-pandemic tourism also had its downsides, as overly crowded cities such as Rome, Venice, and Florence were literally assaulted by tourists all year round, making it impossible for tourists to actually enjoy their stay, and had inhabitants of these cities growing increasingly irritated by the continuous tourist flow. We must remember, though, that this sector in Italy employs one person out of four, and in 2019, this corresponded to 1.3 million people. Sophia and I believe we have the solution to the previously mentioned problems. So without further ado, let me present to you Smart Tourism, an app that allows you to view crowds of people on a map in real time and choose the least crowded route to take when visiting selected places of interest. Born, or at least we hope so, during COVID times, our app easily extends its use to a post-pandemic world where the need to avoid crowds of people is always a plus side when traveling. So how exactly will Smart Tourism detect crowds of people, you may be thinking? Well, thanks to Qubik, a leading company in the business intelligence sector that collects anonymous location data to provide insights into offline consumer behavior. Qubik has now positioned itself in the mobility and COVID-19 sector by collecting first-party location data from only opted-in users every day. In the United States alone, Qubik exploits the largest anonymous database of accurate location data. Now that I've hopefully captured your interest, I'd like to talk to you about the actual costs and revenues that may derive from the creation of this app. The cost structure consists of three points: app creation, Qubik activation costs, and advertisements. While the revenue structure consists of European/Italian bans for the development and support of tourism, commercial activity owners, and the price paid to download the app itself. Let's not forget that the tourism sector has been topic of discussion regarding various recovery plans in Italy and in Europe in general. In fact, it is of every country's economic interest that this sector return to its pre-pandemic numbers. So Italy's Prime Minister Mario Draghi has stated his intentions to launch several non-repayable tenders, such as Cultura Crea, Smart and Start, MiBACT, and Invitalia. Sophia will now go into detail on how we created our app.
Thank you, Julia. Let's start by saying that our service is aimed mainly at an audience of young people aged between 19 to 35 years old, who often travel to both cultural and tourist destinations, particularly in high season, when the turnout is at its peak. So therefore, our service would be most useful. Thanks to the design thinking technique, we first hypothesized our ideal customers, their needs, and their professional background. But we managed to perfect it thanks to the result of our service on travel habits created and shared in the very first part of our project. This is the link if you want to answer, if you'd like to answer. The answer would be essential for the increase of our database for statistical purpose. As we can see from the pie chart, the percentage of positive answer, about 83 out of 98 to the question, would you be interested in an application that in real time indicates the flow of people in a specific touristic place of interest, was successfully very high. Then we moved to an accurate market analysis and identified the direct and indirect competitors. First, we met Google Maps, followed by Where and Wow app, and lastly, Trenord. Unlike the service, this offer function that could implement our project, but which today represents our point of differentiation and strength, among which we find the fact that the flow of people is not limited only to shops, beaches, or trains, but allows to cover a much more wider range of action, both geographically and temporally. As we said before, each type of consumer needs a different approach and marketing strategy to be achieved based on age, needs, and motivation. Since our service is aimed at a young audience with a high interaction attitude, social media must be an integral part of our communication project. Apart from word of mouth, it is essential to create a massive advertising campaign to aim to acquire new customers and facilitate the download and use of the app tools, as well as ensuring a long life on the service market. Its social network and channel, in fact, as its target, to reach a certain slice of market and devices. But how does the application actually work? We have imagined and created a five-step buying process that begins with the download of the app and continues with the upgrade of a new travel experience that, thanks to the high scalability of our business project, could be easily in future experienced worldwide. This is the app. Yes, and it's simple, fast, and highly intuitive, and we'll be able to depict the turnout of the map in real time and will allow you to select places to visit on the map for your multi-day trip and choose the least crowded route to take based on the expected turnout. If you want to download the app, you can scan the QR code, and this is a short video presentation and operation of the app. So thanks for the attention, and let's make Turin safe again.
Okay, thank you, girls. If you wanted to share the link for the survey, you can share on the chat, so we can contribute to give some data on the project. So
thank you.
And also the link for the app if you want. Okay, any questions? No? Okay, so now from Professor Carboni, Toast, please, Nicole.
Okay.
Your team.
I present the last group of Prof. Carboni. The group is formed by Alice, Lisa, Gaia, Lucilla, and Leonardo, but unfortunately, Lucilla and Gaia today are able to be connected with us. And the group will talk about their project Toast, so I give the floor to Alice.
Thank you.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Alice, and I'm here with my team to introduce UToast, a brand new concept of cooking healthy food. The names come from the combination of the verb toast, which means to season, and the letter T in order to achieve a sound like toast. We started this journey thinking about the problem of the alimentation in our society. In fact, nowadays, due to many reasons, it's very hard to maintain a healthy lifestyle. And usually people end up eating low quality food in order to save time and money. However, not everyone knows that they can find a solution that fits all their needs. This is the aim of our business idea. With this project, we want to bring more people into the world of the healthy food, offering them the best customer service, low prices, and obviously allow them to maintain a well-balanced diet. At the same time, respecting our planet. In this slide, we show some design ideas. The keywords are comfort, plants, nature, and open space. Our business idea was made mainly for all those people who don't have much time to eat due to their busy and stressful life. Some example could be a university student or a young business owner.
We lost you. We cannot hear you anymore.
Sto aspettando che entri l'altra ragazza.
Ok.
Devi fare questa slide.
Ah, va bene.
Ok, grazie.
Come si chiama l'altra ragazza? Elisa Famin.
Elisa
Famin.
È collegata.
Riesci ad attivare il microfono? Bene.
Sì, sta cercando un attimo di entrare, di attivare le cose.
Ok, questi sono secondi preziosi, eh? La presentazione non la vediamo più.
Here I am, I have some problem with my connection. So, can you hear me now?
Yes,
yeah.
Please.
Thank you. Sarah is the main character of our journey. She's a student who is very stressed by a very long day at university. So during lunchtime, surfing on the internet, she finds out Toast. She's very interested in our healthy philosophy. So she decided to visit us. At the end of her journey, she comes back to the university very satisfied. On the last line, we can see her emotions during all the steps. Here is our menu. If you want, you can scan the QR code in order to have it in a PDF, or I can introduce it to you. We would like to offer to our clients soup, wrap, salad, and also a dessert. This is our business plan. The key activities of our idea is the production and home delivery. We have some key partners such as suppliers, for example, local farmers. We would like to spread our idea through stores, web app, and the delivery. What makes the difference between us and the others is the price that is lower, a wide section of meals, and the possibility to create your own meal. We would like to establish also a relationship with our clients through a fidelity card, a plastic-free lifestyle, a newsletter, and a community. These are our resources. For example, the physical ones could be stores or equipment, then the humans one, such as sales and kitchen staff, but also riders, and the internet ones, such as website, app, and Wi-Fi. Our revenue streams came from sales of assets and delivery. Cost of structure is composed by fixed costs, such as rents, wages, and Wi-Fi, and semi-variable costs, for example, for the for the electricity. The customer segment we are addressing to, it's sportsmen, students, people who want to get in shape, and people who need a healthy diet. Some interesting data, for example, during the pandemic, 12% of Italians are more are interested in organic products. At the same time, 20% of the Italians are more patriotic, so prefer Italian products, and the 13% focus on eco-sustainable packaging.
Can you hear me? I will talk about our website. This is the TOS website. It has been created because we think that today internet is one of the most important instruments to share and promote a new activity. And as we can see, I created the site to share our other services. For example, as we can see in the other slide, we go on with the slide. The toast up, this is very important also in addition with the Fidelity card that we will share with our customers to concede and define discounts, but also vouchers, and also to understand what products are most important for the different types of customers. Other services that I want to explain are the plastic free, because we won't take the first step to free the world from the plastic bulky product. And another important service that we want to offer to our customers is the food delivery, because it's very important and relevant in this period of pandemic, but we think it will be also very important in future to deliver our products directly to customers' home. And yeah. This is all with this slide. We can go on. This is our Fidelity card, and it will be very important to share our discounts. As I said, we can go on. Yeah, and this is our short analysis of costs and revenues. We think that we will be able to cover all these costs that we found with our financial resources, but we eventually we will be able also to use a credit line. And if we go on, we can see here our analysis graphically. We without that the first year maybe we will have difficulties if we won't reach the range of population and customers that we predicted before, but we think that with at least other 2 years, the activity will be a success and the costs will be much lower than the revenues. Okay, and this is our team. We are five people. And yeah, if I have 1 second, I will show you our website.
Yes.
Can you see?
Yes.
Okay, this is our site. It was be created with HTML language to create the structure, the base structure of the site, and CSS to define the style of the site. This is our menus, and these the services that I explained before. And finally, the forms to have a direct contact with our customers. And yeah, that's all.
Okay, thank you. Okay. I don't see
questions from the judge. So last two groups here in presence, so please waste away from Professoressa Maria Letizia Ruello. Please, Alessia, yes. Come first.
So this is the group of Professor Ruello. I present you Matteo, Andrea, and Sofia with Waste Away. So enjoy your presentation and good luck.
Si vede Adri?
Sì, non metterò la schermata. Ok.
Waste Away. Waste Away is a service designed to make separate waste collection more effective, helping to save the planet and offering a reward to all those who use it. Waste Away, as the name suggested, aims at collecting certain types of plastics from the comfort of your home and then delivering them to the appropriate treatment facilities to be recycled. As emerged from ISPRA data, about 30 million tons of waste were produced in Italy last year. And however, not all of them will have the same destination. Some will end up in storages, some in landfills, and only a part of them will be recycled. This is a problem. And to solve this problem, we need to recycle as much as possible and reintroduce this waste into the market as end of waste. This is the aim of the so-called circular economy, which opposes the current linear system, which is the old way of considering production. Regarding plastics, the main problem in recycling them is that several different plastic materials exist, and each one of them requires a different treatment. Only four of them are completely recyclable: PET, polypropylene, low density and high density polyethylene. These are already collected by the common door-to-door collection, but they get put together with all the other kinds of plastics and then sorted out. This generates loads of plastics that are very dirty, full of impurities and unrelated materials, causing the reduction of quality and quantity of the final product when they will enter the recycle process. In order to completely recycle them, we must own a load that is the most homogeneous as possible. The cleaner it is, the most recyclable it is. And Waste Away does exactly that. From a survey we carried out, we observed that 95% of 330 people pay medium or much attention in sorting waste into the right categories, showing that there is already an interest in the sector from the public. And this interest is also reflected in a possible commitment towards the improvement of the circular economy. From here, Waste Away was born. Waste Away collects a certain plastic waste from the comfort of the user's home through a simple app. The service provides special customized bags with a QR code that will allow the service to identify the users, which will just have to wait for a delivery man to take the bags, bring them to the Waste Away warehouse. And then here, the bags will be carefully checked by special workers who will control the quality and the homogeneity of the waste that has been delivered. And then they'll assign a score based on this to the bag by scanning the QR code. The plastics will be then sold to the facilities, which will appreciate the cleanliness of the load we brought them. An estimate was then made of the proceeds based on the participation of 25% of the population of the market. That is 25% of 1.5 million people. Being aware of the average consumed bottle per year, we would get 1.3 million euros per year selling them to the appropriate recycling plants. The users will interact with the service by downloading an app. which allows them to create a personal profile where they can book the personalized bags and the collection of those bags once they're filled, accumulate e-points and redeem voucher and rewards, monitor the amount of waste produced and then recycled, and receive instructions on the correct disposal and compaction of the materials and the objects. Through the app, WasteAway is able to communicate easily and quickly with the users, and it relies on the app to share the improvements and the goals achieved, to inform on the recycle processes the waste has to go through, and to assign the e-points to the single users, guaranteeing efficiency and respect for the user's privacy. In fact, the operator in the warehouse who checks the bags and assigns the points does not see whose bag it is, but only sees the QR code. The app will then associate the QR code with the user code. There are many reasons to take advantage of this service. It's a simple service to give away plastic weights and earn vouchers in return, to improve the circular economy by simplifying the recycling process, and to drastically reduce the volume of irrecoverable waste, and even pollution can be lowered. We started with PE, PP, and PET because they are the simplest material to divide and to collect. But in the near future, we can see ourselves controlling other kinds of plastics and also other types of materials, such as aluminum or paper. We think the environmental issue is very important, and it concerns the future of our world and especially the future of young people. So let's make the difference great again. And if you want to know more about it, we're open to questions. Thanks for your attention.
Okay, let's see if
nothing about the economic feasibility. Have you any idea of the
Economic feasibility?
The cost of implementing this?
The revenues are from the selling of this type of the sellings of the plastics to the recycling facilities. The recycling facilities buy plastics and buy plastics for a higher price if the plastics are cleaner and more homogeneous. Okay. So by selling PET, polypropylene, and polyethylene, we would cover the costs of the warehouse.
You save the cost of separating the different plastics.
Yes. We ask the user to separate the plastics so that we have a load that is homogeneous and that can be recycled better and that is more valuable to the recycled plants.
Okay, thank you. Let's see if we have a question here. No. Okay, thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So now, Jacob Mesh from Professor Spanoli.
Okay. They are the last group of Professor Manetin, and I think they are the class of the food marketing and management. Their project is called ZeroMatch. And today, me and Karolina will make the presentation.
So good morning, everyone, and welcome to our presentation. My name is Karolina, and I will show you how our idea of YogaMatch we built our marketing plan. This is our team. We are five students of University Politecnica della Marche. We have different experience. We have different knowledge, but we are the same values. We are always care about healthy lifestyle and healthy food. first slide is about who are we empathizing with. We choose people with sedentary lifestyle because, as you know, the background is the COVID-19. A lot of people have to change their lifestyle and move work to home, move study to home. So now they are struggling with obesity or gaining weight, and in the same time, they have problems to eat healthy and to move. Our personas are Marco, who is 35 years old and he is a corporate employee. He's looking for healthy and tasty food. Before he was working in the company, but now he's working at home and he doesn't have any opportunity to choose his healthy product. As the same is Aurora, who is a student. When she's studying at home, she doesn't have any opportunity to choose a healthy product and care of healthy lifestyle. About our design criteria, we would like to explore low fat content, no sugar, eye-catching and eco-friendly packaging, special ingredients with unique flavors, and fiber composition to help digestion.
So to make our design criteria come true, we come up with the idea, which is yoga mat. Our prototype, we're using matcha, is a power green tea with another health benefit. To have one of them is reduce cholesterol, and also it has very strong flavor. This matcha is very popular in Asia, but I realize that in Europe, in Western culture, it's not really popular. Also, instead of using sugar, we're using sweetener. It gives the sweet taste for the yogurt without increasing any calories. And we're using skim milk with low fat and low calories. And also we using inulin, is a fiber, is important to the digestion and also make the consistency for the yogurt. So what make our product different? First is a dairy product, but it's with low fat and no sugar. It have a special flavor for matcha, and I'm sure that it's really hard to find in the supermarket in Italy and Europe. It's also very nutrient dense, and also we're using glass for the packaging, which is transparent. You can see the color of the product, and also it's 100% recycled, and also we're using inulin. It's a soluble fiber helping the digestion. To test our product, we come up with a hypothesis that our product will have a bad taste. Our hypothesis is wrong if 90% of our customers do not like the taste of our product, and we're measuring the taste and the mouthfeel, and we expect our customer to like the taste in favor of our low-calorie product. So we did the testing with 10 people rating our product from the scale 1 to 10, and we consider if the rate to 7 to 10 is mean they like the product. So the result that very positive, the score around 1.125 out of 10, and we got very good feedback that they like the taste, the flavor, and they think that the flavor is very particular and unique. So for further step, we expect to first testing further market for our product. Secondly, we want to know the cell life of the test the cell life of product, and also finding the sort of the matcha for our product. We expect to support the small business, small farmer from Southeast Asia country, and thank you for your attention.
Yes, Leonardo, please.
I pretty much the idea. I'm very fond of yogurt, so I will taste it definitely. Again, any because yogurt is quite cheap and available in supermarkets. Have you any idea of the cost of is the is it comparable with the yogurt you find in supermarkets or much more expensive?
When I do the test, it's not really like it's depend on the quality of the matcha and the sort of the matcha where I get it from. So I expect that if I get it, the matcha from a small business or small farmer in my country, in Vietnam, this will be cheaper priors. So I think the price will be competitive for the other product in the supermarket.
Okay. Yes. A question from Lorenzo Compagnucci, please. Lorenzo.
Thank you for the presentation. A very short question. From a communication standpoint, rather than stressing the fact that the product is for sedentary people, maybe it could be useful to stress more the healthy aspects of the product in order to be more general without addressing in a negative way specific target of customers.
Yes, I think that we choose our sedentary people lifestyle as an example, but I think our product can target a lot of people. Also from children to adults, they can enjoy yogurt as well.
Okay. Thank you. So now it's time to vote. So gentilmente a tutti i membri della giuria, finalizzate le vostre votazioni e poi inviate il modulo in modo tale che noi possiamo fare tutti i calcoli. Invito anche Considi, Intesa San Paolo e Warehouse di collegarsi dopo la votazione al link Teams che vi abbiamo dato, così definiamo bene l'assegnazione dei premi. Quindi abbiamo 5 minuti di tempo. Insomma, thanks to all the students and to all the teacher for the hard work, because all the presentation were really, really well designed. We have 5 minutes to organize all the results and then the prize.
Okay, just to while waiting for the results and for the winners, of course, if there are here or online the teachers who participated, we will be glad to hear from them if you want to intervene. Otherwise, I congratulate very much with all the students and then teachers and tutors. We had very interesting ideas, very, very interesting presentations, very well done. It was very hard to make it, to give votes, and but besides the winners, of course, there will be winners, but I hope that all of you learned a lot from this experience in developing your ideas, but especially in interacting between you and interacting with the tutors and with the teachers. So for those of you, for the groups, the teams, that will consider this not as the final step. So if you want to continue on developing your idea, please consider that there are people in the university, Università Politecnica delle Marche, but also in the University of Urbino. There are people who are able and willing to support you. So please don't hesitate to ask for help if you want to go on in developing your idea. And as Diego mentioned, my colleague during the interval, there's a lot of competitions in which you can participate and refine your idea and interact with other people, maybe developing ideas. A lot of projects were on the green, no? The green agenda, on the sustainable agenda. So it's a very hot topic, this. And so I'm sure there will be possibility for you to present your ideas in different scenarios and get maybe more advice or getting money or getting resources to go on. So, okay, we really look forward to hearing about you or your ideas in the future. And I don't know if someone in the audience or here wants to say something. I would be glad to share while we are waiting for the results. And of course, we look forward for the next edition, not for the other people involved in that. I see Lorenzo on the screen. I hope that next time also Macerata will join again.
I see.
As Francesca Cesaroni said this morning, the possibility to interact between teachers of different universities and different backgrounds is a great value. So I hope.
Paola
asked
for
okay.
To speak.
Yeah, Paola, please, Paola.
Mi sentite?
Sì.
Molto debolmente, Paola, please.
Eppure sto.
Parla più forte.
Parlo più forte. Adesso va meglio?
Sì, dai, ti sentiamo.
Allora, buona giornata a tutti. Ho passato una mattina veramente interessante, formativa. E sono molto contenta, felice di essere con voi. Questo è si dimostra sempre di più che è un buon modello, una buona metodologia per attivare il mindset imprenditoriale nelle nostre studentesse e nostri studentessi. Lavoriamo a questo progetto da diversi anni. Io ringrazio Donato Iacobucci, Francesca Micozzi, Francesca Cesaroni, perché con me fin dall'inizio hanno creduto in questo progetto, e va a loro tutto il merito, e anche ai professori dell'università, a quelli ho visto anche Rossi e Compagnucci che sono nella giuria, e gli altri stakeholder. E niente, quest'anno i progetti sono stati veramente bellissimi. È stato anche un po' difficile poi dare una valutazione, dimostra che possiamo rilanciare, possiamo essere certi, insomma, del rilancio dello spirito imprenditoriale in questa regione. Quindi grazie, complimenti e buon proseguimento a tutti. E comunque vada, chiunque vinca, anche gli altri hanno vinto lo stesso, perché hanno fatto dei lavori veramente eccellenti.
Grazie Paola. I'm just talking to the students. Paola Paolinelli is from Marche region and was responsible for a European project on which this project of Impresa in Aula started a few years ago. So it was a best practice that we discovered in other universities in the EU, and thanks to Paola, we applied here for the first time 2 years ago, and we are continuing. So Paola, many thanks, and I'm sure that this is a journey that will continue and will improve.
Sorry, Donato, can I?
Yes, I know.
Word only to say hello to Paola and to thank you, because you are the first that start this project. So we have to thank you for your effort, your commitment, the energy that you transmitted to all of us. And I'm very pleased to be here again to collaborate in this project that we consider very important, useful for us and for our students. I'm also very pleased to note that our students are very sensitive to environment, to sustainability, and to some of the key trends of this period. And so I think that this is very important, and I agree with you that this morning, very interesting projects have been presented. So I'm sure that we could go on in the next years with other colleagues from our university and from also Macerata and Camerino, who are our partners. And so thank you. And
thank you, Francesca. Maybe we can, while waiting for the results, we can hear from the organizations that proposed the prizes. Francesca, help me. Who are from Intesa San Paolo, Consigli, and
Warehouse.
Maybe you want to give us some information about the prizes.
Probably Ronnie is not online anymore. Yes. We have Intesa San Paolo. I don't know if Nicola Tommasi or Lubatti wanted to explain the prize. Alessandro, so now for Intesa San Paolo, then Alessandro Fontana for Consigli.
Informale.
I think I'm Raffaele Zanoli from the Faculty of Agriculture, Department of Agriculture, and I think that we have.
No.
So I have to say that this experience, which is now, I think it's the third or fourth year.
For you, it's the third year.
When we started, I think this is a very important pedagogical tool, because it's not just a competition inside a business competition, but it's something that gives students, at least in our courses, some prospects of seeing something which is not just studying for an exam. So it's always, I think, that teaching activities like this and gamification sometimes, this is not a game, but it's in a way, it should be taken as a sport competition. So it's not important who is winning, it's important to participate, but it gives you the idea that your work is not just to be presented to the teacher, to your teacher, but a larger audience that will evaluate from the industry, from other teachers and so on. I think this is something that is peculiar, and this experience, I hope it will continue. There should be more initiative like that, because I think this makes, not only in business, I think in many other realms, I think that making concrete applications and understanding that teaching is and learning is not just something to be confined in the classrooms, but can be open to relationship with the world and with different opinions of different groups and different faculties, different departments is very important. So as usual, my students always participate, all the class participates. We have three teams every year, so all the class always participate to this. And I think that it's a real an experience that has given extra motivation for my students to follow the course. Thank you again.
Thank you.
No. Good morning, everyone, or everybody. Anyway, I am Maria Tizzeruello, a teacher for. It is my first class because I am a researcher, not a professor. So this here was my first class. And I am very happy of this project that make more alive so sad and boring online classroom. And I perceived this project as trainee, not as trainer, because it is for me the first time that I match with this new style of learning by doing. But I prefer the original name of this project, Aula Emprende. It is more coherent with the aim, the goal, the key words of this style of study. Thank you.
I see Paola. I agree. I think that Paola, we have to change it. Impresa in aula doesn't convey the idea that we are not just working to promote startups and new firms. And as I said at the beginning, entrepreneurship education has a much broader meaning. So. I agree that the original name Aula Emprende is something at the entrepreneurial class. I don't know how to translate it. Something like this: we want a classroom to be entrepreneurial, in a way. Okay, please.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I want to know.
But you have to come here, otherwise, please. The microphone is there, so.
Good morning. I have. I want to know if it's possible after the results, if we can have the comments about our project by the judge.
Okay.
If because we want to improve our idea in that case, so we want to know.
Okay.
The judge. Thank you.
Okay. We may ask. I don't know what it's Roberta. How much time?
1 minute.
1 minute. it's to raise the suspense. No, this is about as Raffaele said, this is not a competition. The reward are not the prizes. The reward is what you learn during the program. So. That's the basic reward. It's a very different situation in terms of there are a lot of apps. It was as usual, but also some hard products, food products or equipment. So a large array of projects and situations. Okay. Suspense. Of course, the price is not in terms of money. It's we can give money. It is not the situation, but in terms of a further possibility for you to learn and to acquire support from these organizations.
Don't have a thrilling music.
Don't have music to entertain. No, I understand that it's because all the projects were very interesting. So it was so it's very difficult for the people in the jury to give votes. That's why that's it. Maybe Paola, you can give us the good news that we can start in September with the support of the Marche region, or not yet?
Ma io Spererei proprio di sì. Adesso abbiamo in cantiere altri due avvisi, uno per uscito, un altro sta per uscire, e conterei di poter inserire anche questo di impresa in aula o aula imprende, as you like. Dobbiamo ancora fare dei passaggi interni, anche perché, scusate se sarò molto prosaica, ma il mio ufficio è formato da me e un collaboratore a mezzo servizio, quindi le idee ci sono, però poi dopo gestire progetti come questi da un punto di vista anche del sistema informativo è molto complesso, quindi come dire, non è cattiva volontà, però dobbiamo anche un po' assestarci, finirci di assestare internamente da un punto di vista delle risorse umane. Però io conto proprio di sì, anche perché anche stamattina, insomma, voi avete fatto tutto questo lavoro in periodo di Covid, a scartamento ridotto, senza risorse aggiuntive, mi sembrano dei risultati eccellenti, che sarebbe veramente poco sensato non dargli il giusto rilievo e anche le potenzialità ulteriori che questo tipo di progetto ha. La cosa che trovo più interessante, vabbè, a parte, voglio dire, diciamo, le idee, la creatività degli studenti, ma anche il coinvolgimento a livello decisionale dei nostri atenei e dei professori, perché veramente questo segna e sottolinea un salto di qualità veramente, veramente importante, importante in un momento come questo, dopo il terremoto e dopo il Covid per noi. Quindi
va bene, ma noi, come diceva prima Raffaele Zanoli, noi pensiamo che sia veramente per gli studenti, insomma, una esperienza veramente importante, quindi sicuramente, questo lo dico anche ai colleghi delle altre università, insomma, sicuramente noi continueremo, insomma, ormai cerchiamo di renderla un'attività assolutamente di routine in tutti i semestri, anzi l'idea è quella di creare un effetto snowball, per cui ogni anno aggiungiamo nuovi colleghi, nuovi professori, e anche, no, è interessante anche, credo, insomma, ce lo possono testimoniare l'apprendimento che si fa reciprocamente, insomma, per affinare queste cose, insomma, quindi da settembre riprendiamo, poi se appunto ci potrà essere la possibilità di un accompagnamento anche in termini di sostegno di risorse da parte della regione, ovviamente questo aiuterebbe molto, soprattutto aiuta molto nello scambio tra atenei, perché ovviamente l'organizzazione con più atenei diventa più costosa, più onerosa. Guardo, ci siamo, Francesca. No.
Allora, ok, ci siamo. Ringraziamo ancora la giuria, scusate l'attesa, ma appunto abbiamo analizzato tutte le valutazioni. Allora, i premi sono tre, quindi consigli. Il premio di consigli offerto da consigli è stato vinto da Panda Cream. Ho la parola a Alessandro Fontana, se vuole dire qualcosa sul premio. Prego, venite ragazze, ragazzi.
Io non ce l'ho, ce l'hanno loro.
Sì.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Hello?
Devi condividerlo.
Sì, sì. Ok, so First of all, I'd like to say thank you to everybody and congratulations to Pandacream. Concidi is a consulting firm which is specialized since 30 years in mainly in lean thinking. So the goal of Concidi is to help clients to improve and innovate their processes and business models. And as a partner of this program, the opportunity we would like to offer to this amazing team is to have a live training on lean thinking and lean production, which could help to put on the ground their, or to better understand how to put on the ground their idea and how to reach their goals. So since the training are highly experiential and in presence, and you know, we have all the COVID restrictions and so on, we can't precisely define the dates yet, but of course, as soon as an opportunity to let external people to join one of the trainings will be available, each participant of the winner group will be individually invited. So we are very happy to invite you to these trainings, and congratulations again for the great job you have done.
Thank you.
Ok, un altro riconoscimento per Manci Soi. Ah, online, ok. Offerto da Warehouse, purtroppo il Ronnie Garattoni non è qui, comunque è una business clinic, è un tutoraggio all'idea con il co-working warehouse di Marotta, quindi è un attore dell'ecosistema molto attivo, dell'ecosistema imprenditoriale regionale molto attivo, noi ci collaboriamo da anni e quindi sarete seguiti dal team di warehouse per appunto migliorare e comunque sviluppare meglio la vostra idea. Bene?
E la foto?
La foto sono tutti online, quindi eccolo il eccolo il premio.
Grazie, grazie mille.
Sì, magari se vogliono parlare.
Da lì abbiamo attivato l'audio.
Ah, ok.
E magari mettere la loro. Mettere la... Parlate pure, ragazzi, così vi vediamo.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It was a really good experience.
Okay. Member of the teams. Okay. Okay.
L'altro premio offerto da Intesa, non so se ci sono i referenti di Intesa, benissimo. Nico Plastic.
Sì, sì, presenti. Buongiorno a tutti.
Sì, forse Nicola, lascio a te la parola, prego ragazze.
Non so se mi vedete, sto provando ad attivare il video, però non so se... vedo che... Comunque, i complimenti a tutti i ragazzi, assolutamente, è per un piacere essere presenti anche... Ecco, forse mi vedete, sono qui dall'ufficio. Per noi è una nuova occasione anche quest'anno di essere presenti e ci fa piacere e assolutamente partecipare, complimenti ancora. E per i ragazzi che hanno vinto il nostro premio, vi aspettiamo. A presto.
Grazie mille. Grazie.
Bene, allora possiamo concludere. We can conclude this is really nice for me and also I think I hope also for you. Moni. And for the students that are here in present at the exit, you can
take your certificate of attendance of this project. So, and for the others that are online, you can speak with your tutor, and then we will organize an appointment or a meeting for give you the certificate. So. you wanted to be all online, or you know, okay. So thank you to everyone. See you next year. Bye.
Bye.